Welcome everyone to USA Baseball Virtual Community Coaches Clinic number 8. I'm your host, Andrew Bartman, the Director of Coaching Development at USA Baseball. Please take time to check in with us in the chat feature. The chat feature is for checking in, letting everybody know who you are. Tell us where you're coaching at, what level you coach, where you're from, all that good stuff. We have people around the world join these webinars. We have people from Australia, Great Britain, Indonesia, Malaysia, India, Germany, all over the place. Thank you for taking time today, wherever, whatever time it is, where you're at. Thanks for joining us today. As I noted to Joe Pallone, this is a webinar, not a meeting, so only myself as the host and our presenters will have access to the microphone and to video capabilities. So it's not like a typical Zoom meeting with all the different blocks everywhere. So please just sit back, listen, take notes. I will post the link to all of the attendee notes if you did not get that, about the outlines in the packet. If you didn't get that email today, I'll post it in the chat so you can check that out and follow along with our presenters. And also, you can, at the end of today, you can visit usabaseballshop.com, get any of your USA Baseball gear that you wish, from clothing to accessories, men's, women's, kids, we got it all. You get 20% off your order today, including sale items. 20% off using the code CLINIC8, CLINIC, and then the number 8 at usabaseballshop.com. So without further ado, I've got a few more items to detail about USA Baseball development, our offerings, our free resources. I will do that periodically throughout between speakers, but let's get rolling today with Rob Smith, my good friend, the head coach at Ohio University, pitching coach for a long, long time, highly successful pitching coach for a long, long time before becoming a head coach. Rob, thank you for joining us today, and the floor is yours.
I appreciate it, Andrew. Thanks for having me. Really excited to kind of run through this. So the topic that I wanted to take on today was talking about developing pitchers, but really looking at it from a much larger view and how we can roadmap that process for pitchers of all ages. I think it's important as we look to develop a pitcher, I think we need to know exactly what the entire plan may encompass. But then I also think it's important that once we recognize the athlete we're working with, where are we as coaches within that plan? And are we focusing our time and effort in the right areas? And so I've broken it down into sort of four main categories of development that pitchers will go through. The first one is skill development. The second area that we'll look to develop pitchers in will be strength and recovery. The third area that we'll look to develop pitchers in is on the mental emotional side. And then the final piece will be nutritional development that we would talk to. And so those four main areas is where we're going to start. That's our general roadmap. Now, what area we engage depends on the age of the athlete, depends on the advancement of the athlete, and certainly depends on what the needs for that pitcher are going to be at his given level. And so when we look at our phases of focus, I think it's important to understand these phases because it will certainly create the plan and will dictate what we as coaches need to focus on and put our energies in. So when you look at skill development, that is really the most fun and the easiest point of entry for all kids that start to pitch. And this begins in youth ball. This actually begins really when you start playing catch with your dad or mom in the backyard, where you start to understand the process of throwing a baseball and what that means and starting to engage some of the mechanical aspects and starting to engage very basic things about throwing a baseball and then ultimately translating that into pitching. And that will usually last, generally speaking, anywhere from, you know, when you're 6 years old, 7 years old, all the way up until right before high school or right as athletes get into high school. Most, if not all, of the attention and focus that we as coaches will spend in that age group will be designed to develop skill and to work on skill and really ultimately just develop an enjoyment of the game. The second phase that a pitcher will normally go through when you're looking at the roadmap to development will be the strength and recovery phase. And generally, pitchers are going to be exposed to this in early high school, right? The things that they're going to start to understand from a training perspective is now that you've gotten out of your youth ball area, you're entering into the high school age, the players have started now, that the rosters have gotten smaller, and now the games are going to start to become obviously more and more competitive and guys start to develop some potential goals they may have for themselves. And so you start to get exposed to the weight room in high school. Obviously you can track that. You can see that there's not very many weight rooms at all in junior high schools, but you'll find them in high schools, right? And so that's where that process starts to come. Guys want to start getting in there. They want to start working a little bit on developing strength. I think one of the things that we see from a strength and recovery perspective is they'll start to really engage the work aspect and working mental hurdles to overcome and some of the things that I think the weight room certainly can develop and provide pitchers as well. This is a lot of times where you'll start to see kids make velocity gains when they start to get stronger and they put time into the weight room. By this point, they've started to get a sense of what their delivery may look like, what the arm action may look like, and now they enter that phase of understanding strength and recovery. The third phase of development, which a lot of time is late high school and into college, is the mental-emotional component. It requires a level of maturity and obviously emotional intelligence to be able to dive into that. And so when you look at it dealing with a youth athlete, and I've got four kids myself that have all been involved in athletics, is there's certain aspects of the mental game you can talk about, but ultimately if they don't have the emotional intelligence or the maturity to really engage and wrap their head around it, it makes it very difficult to dive into those things. And so you have to sort of let that part of it naturally occur and understand that the player you're dealing with may or may not be really ready to start understanding some concepts of that and how to negotiate that. And then the last phase of focus is the nutritional piece. And really a lot of pitchers start to look at that late in college into pro ball. It does require the most discipline. It requires the most commitment. In a lot of ways, it can probably be the least amount of fun of the four phases because it just requires additional money. It requires a lot of, like I said, discipline and effort to eat right and fuel your body right. Going out and throwing a baseball is generally fun for most guys. Most guys enjoy lifting and getting in the weight room. I think as you get older, you appreciate the value of managing your mental game. But the last piece is that nutritional piece that can be very, very challenging for guys to really get committed to. But as you'll see, as pitchers as they really go through the process and they get into professional baseball, that tends to be the last frontier where they try to maximize the last ounce of opportunity they have to get themselves above everybody else. And so those are the four phases of focus. That's where we sort of enter those individual components of development. So now when we break it down and we start to talk about sort of the tools of the trade in these different areas, we're going to come back to the skill development again because it's the most easiest point of entry and it's where we start with developing pitchers. And the most basic concept is their mechanics, right? And so that's where we generally start with pitchers at the youth level. We start to try to develop some semblance of a delivery. We try to look at different mechanical things that we can apply to them. We start to teach them about how to work out of a windup, how to work out of a stretch, how their hands and their body are supposed to coordinate and work together. When we talk about mechanics, there's four main things that I like to emphasize to pitchers. The first is balance. And really for me, it's not a matter of just, hey, do you have a balance point? But it's balance not only just in how your body positions itself, but also balance in your movements and how your body flows from the beginning of the delivery all the way to the end. The second component of mechanics that I think are important to look at from a broad scope is direction. I'm not necessarily saying there's a right or wrong direction. I know some guys generally may stride across their body. Some guys may stride a little bit open. I think a lot of it depends on just understanding how that direction affects their delivery. That's when you start to make changes. I've worked with a lot of pitchers that some stride a little open, some stride a little closed. They can still be very effective, but you have to balance that out and determine how does that direction play in their delivery and their mechanics. That may dictate where we stand on the mound. That may dictate what their repertoire maybe is developed as. There's a lot of things. So it's not a hardcore, hey, you must have this type of direction. I think it's just understanding what the direction of their delivery is. And ultimately, that'll help us in their development process. The third component for me is rhythm of mechanics. And so rhythm to me is how those movements connect, right? And I look at it a lot like I like to compare it to dancing. When you see dancers or guys or girls that can really, really dance well, they've got a rhythm to what they do, right? The movements as they move through all have a connection point and just kind of flow together. And a pitching delivery is much the same way. The rhythm that a pitcher has in their mechanics will show the ease for which one movement leads to the next and then leads to the next. And so I think working through rhythm with a pitcher is really important to get them to understand how those dots connect as they move from point A to point B. And then the last component is tempo. So tempo is the fourth piece of really, for me, the mechanical puzzle. And tempo to me is just how fast are we moving, right? And so we understand that we're working for good balance throughout the delivery. We understand how our direction plays a role in our ability to throw strikes. We understand how our rhythm connects our motion and allows for us to move more efficiently. And now we have to consider the tempo. And within that delivery, how fast are we wanting to deliver my body? And for some pitchers, we got to slow them down a little bit. For other pitchers, we want to speed them up so we can deliver and create more power and force. And again, it's just a matter of recognizing what that pitcher needs and how their tempo can affect their delivery in a positive or a negative manner. Other tools of the trade for skill work, obviously throwing strikes. I know it's a kind of an obvious concept, but it is a very important concept. I think it's one that can get lost sometimes. Obviously, now we're in the world of, you know, velocity development, and velocity is very, very important. There's no question. But the game is built and based on throwing strikes. It's no more complicated than that. If you can't throw strikes, generally then you become a left fielder with a good arm, right? You have to be able to throw strikes. That has to be part of the skill development. You have to be able to understand the value of it. And it's got to be a starting point, I think, for all pitchers to work on, is understanding how to throw the ball over the plate. Additional areas to skill would be arm action development. There's some things as pitchers start to get a little bit older, you can engage in some various drills that can clean up the efficiency of their arm action, which in turn may help them throw more strikes. May also help them increase velocity. There's a lot of things that can go into that process. Pitch variation is a fancy word for just learning grips, essentially. Understanding and learning how to throw a changeup, how to throw a breaking ball when the time is appropriate, how to throw a slider, how to throw two seamers, four seamers. Realizing and understanding how grips and wrist position can affect how the ball moves and whether or not you can gain or reduce velocity on the pitch. And obviously that's a big part, especially once you get through the early phases of development for a youth pitcher and you've started to put together a delivery, you're generally just throwing fastballs, you're generally just trying to throw strikes. But as they start to develop and they get a little older, now we start to look at it and say, all right, can we teach you a changeup? Can we teach you a two-seam fastball? And then obviously as they get a little older, you start understanding and teaching them how to spin the ball and how wrist position can have an effect on how the ball spins and moves as it moves to home plate. The last two components generally are ones you focus on probably later in high school. You start talking about PFP and fielding your position because the bunt game gets involved as the games are a little bit more strategically managed. Unlike generally like a little league game, most of the times guys are allowed just to play. You don't have a lot of defensive plays that you need to navigate. But once you get into high school ball, you know, there will be some bunts when they're moving runners to try to get a game-winning score and whatnot. And so you have to have some awareness of that. And then obviously picks is part of the skill bucket because as you get to certain components at certain levels, base runners start to steal bases, and you as a pitcher have to now understand the skill of navigating, not only just picking to first, but at times maybe altering your delivery so you can be quicker to the plate and also managing both still delivering strikes and managing the running game. And so that's what you have kind of in that skill development piece from a big picture standpoint. There's a lot of things you can mix and match in that, right? And I'm a big believer that there's more than one way to skin a cat. I think you get in this Twitter pitching discussion, and there's a lot of battles that go on a lot of times about everybody's just sort of in their corner and like saying, this is the way you do it, and that's the way you do it. I think if you're going to be a good coach, you've got to have a buffet of knowledge. You have to have a large understanding of various options, various mechanical philosophies. You have to understand the various ways that kids are being taught and trained, because when you get them, I think it's important to realize that they may have been taught a certain way, and you don't have to completely reprogram that, right? You don't have to live and die by one philosophy. I think you have to have a broad understanding of several ideas and philosophies so that you and that athlete can engage in a way that they can remain comfortable, but you can make progress. I think we get caught up too much in this one way to do it type mentality. And I think players, their development gets crushed by it because they're pulled in a million different directions. And I'm not a big fan of just standing on one hill and saying, this is what mechanics look like. I think you have to have an understanding of the broad principles that are required in mechanics, but what drills you use to train some of those broader principles, I think is a big part of trial and error. I think it's feel. I think it's what makes an athlete comfortable. I think sometimes it's what you're comfortable explaining and being able to teach. Along the same lines, I think if there's some things that will help an athlete and you're not comfortable with that, you have to be okay to pass them on to somebody else and let that person help that pitcher understand the concepts that they're being taught. And I think there's a little bit of that that goes on. I even do that at the college level, where I'll have pitchers that maybe have a guy they worked with indoors. They had a lesson guy in high school. And I'm okay if there's some concepts and things that make that pitcher better, and that instructor can articulate that or understand that concept a little bit better than me. My bottom line is I want that pitcher to get better. And so if that time with another instructor helps, then let's do it. By all means, give it a shot, bring it back, and we'll work together to try to navigate that piece. So that's kind of what you see in the skill bucket. On the strength and recovery piece, again, this is for guys that are going to be working with early into later high school athletes. You get into body work and flex work, which that can start a little bit more on the youth side. That's basically strength and flexibility development with nothing more than body weight. So a basic push-up, any kind of core work, any kind of real legitimate flex work, flexibility, range of motion work, all of that certainly can be done. I would say late junior high into early high school. Bands can be introduced, I think, at any point to a youth pitcher. I think it's good to get them on bands early just to get them comfortable with the process of it and starting to engage and learn some movements. I prefer Jaeger bands. I think they're probably one of the best ones out there. They have a nice, simple program. Youth pitchers can easily understand and engage that. I like crossover symmetry. I think it's another solid program that works. But there's several different types of band exercises that you can utilize. You start to transition into medi balls and plyo balls. And so now we're working out of body weight and we're working into outside weighted implements, right? Weighted balls, medicine balls. We're taking range of motions, but yet we're moving weight in some capacity. And now that we added medicine balls and plyo balls, this is a little bit more of an advanced thing. Generally speaking, you're going to be doing this later in the junior high, early high school development piece, and you'll start to introduce and have that be part of their strength and recovery process. And then as we get into high school and obviously into college and your professional baseball, you have machines and free weights. And the biggest difference between machines and free weights, obviously machines, it's outside weighted implements that you're moving that have a predetermined movement pattern. Free weights are outside weighted implements that the athlete has to determine the movement pattern. Generally speaking, free weights will help you gain strength faster than machines, but machines generally are a better way to engage the weightlifting process because it's safer and easier as the movement patterns are already predetermined. So that's the strength and recovery piece. If I'm talking with youth coaches, I generally tend to lean towards focusing on body and flex work first, starting to develop some range of motion activities, getting guys to understand that they can do some additional things outside of skill work. And then the first outside implement I would recommend introducing are bands, because that's the easiest. The movement patterns are pretty simple. It doesn't require a lot of advanced movement understanding to get into bands. Medi balls and plyo balls, I think you start to now get a little bit more advanced in what you're trying to do. And that's not to say that a 12-year-old couldn't engage those things, but probably need to be a little bit more of an advanced 12-year-old. And probably you have to be comfortable with where they're at from their skill development. If we're really, really, really far behind on skill and we can't throw strikes and we don't understand how to put together a delivery yet, I don't know how much time I want to waste in a practice on, you know, flexibility work and bands and things of that sort. I think we have to understand where that pitcher is before we start to engage the different phases of the development. The third one, mental emotional, when we're talking about these tools, I think the most simplest one to introduce is breathing. I think younger players can understand that concept. I think it's a very simple concept as you try to teach youth pitchers just to breathe as they're out there pitching. I think it's a very quick and noticeable result-based thing that they can do. And they can see the results from that very quickly. And so breathing for me is the first thing that I would introduce from a mental emotional standpoint. Visualization, I think, is the next part, right? Every kid actually sort of already does that. A lot of kids visualize themselves pitching in the big league someday, or they're visualizing themselves on TV in a college uniform. And so they sort of understand that concept. So I think visualization is a positive thing that we can engage early from a mental emotional standpoint and allow them to kind of build on that. As they get a little older, and I think it requires probably into high school for sure, self-awareness and behavior recognition. That's a very difficult one. Obviously, when you circle back and we all think about when we were 8 years old and, you know, we gave up the game-winning hit as a pitcher, and we cry as we're walking off the field, right? Well, that's because our emotions control us, right, at a young age, and we don't have the self-awareness or behavior recognition to understand that literally we're crying in front of the entire crowd. And as you get older, you start to understand those feelings and how to manage those feelings and how to navigate them. Doesn't mean you're not any more upset. Doesn't mean you're not any less sad about performing poorly or losing a game, but you just recognize the feeling and you learn how to control the behavior so that it doesn't control you, right? And then the last one is confidence in dealing with failure. I think as expectations begin to rise and players have they feel pressure, games are on television, there's a scoreboard, there's a meaning behind it, it's a sectional championship or a state championship or a college tournament or whatever it might be, you start to recognize the magnitude of what you're performing in. And now that component of failure and dealing with the possibility of failure can really become overwhelming. And again, going back to when we're in Little League, you know, for a lot of Little League players, they're playing, they're having fun, they're enjoying it. And really the thing they're concerned with is when the game's over, I get to go get an ice cream cone, right? And so the outcome of the game isn't necessarily nearly as overwhelming at times versus obviously if you're pitching in a state championship game at the high school level, you realize that this pitch or this at bat can determine the totality of months and months of work that you and your teammates put in. It's all come down to one moment, and that can be very overwhelming. And so understanding that confidence piece and dealing with failure becomes a big component. As we look at the nutritional side of things, real simply, and again, this is more advanced, but you start to, you know, athletes, they start to, at an advanced age, especially in the college, understanding how sugar affects you, understanding how alcohol can negatively affect you, getting into supplements and how that can enhance strength training, then obviously understanding meal plans and how that can affect just how your body's fueled and things of that sort. And so again, these are sorts of things you won't talk about at the youth level because there's a million other things to concern ourselves with. But ultimately, it is the last phase generally of skill or of development for a pitcher that we start to see them engage in. So understanding the order of the last piece here before I wrap up, I think the first and foremost, when we're talking about developing pitchers, they must gain an interest in the game. That's why the skill component is the easiest and the best way to engage baseball. I think if we put a youth league pitcher and the first thing we did was start to teach him how to squat, I think he'd lose interest pretty fast, right? That's a whole another level of commitment to get into a weight room and put time in. I think gaining interest in the game is the first introduction to development, and that starts with skill and throwing a baseball and learning how to pitch. I think then once you determine that the game is a focus, I think it opens up the possibilities to be willing to put more work in to get better. And so now that I've gained an interest in the game, I love playing the game, I enjoy it, and now I want to get better, I'm willing to get into that weight room and try to get stronger to improve myself. Then as the workload increases, as does expectations, right, and the need to manage the mental game. So now not only am I playing, but I'm now putting in all this extra time outside of the game itself to prepare, and now the expectations for my performance are elevated both by myself and the people around me. So it requires me to start to engage this mental game and navigate that. And then finally, if I've gotten an elite status, that commitment level will match the needed discipline to succeed. And that's where nutrition comes in. Once I've made myself an elite pitcher, I'm now a high level college pitcher. I've got a chance to play professionally. I've got to really now elevate my commitment level, and I'm probably ready to elevate my commitment level and make better decisions about what I eat and how I live so that ultimately now I can perform better and make a living out of this or get a paycheck from it. So in summary, those are the four areas of development as you're looking at developing pitchers: skill, strength and recovery, mental, emotional, nutritional. I think you as a coach have to identify what level of athlete you're working with. And I think that will give you pretty good guidance of where you should be on that spectrum and how you can create entry points to those four areas of development as you navigate.
Right on time, baby, Coach Smith. I know that you've got a lot more that you could share with everybody, but thank you for condensing that in, and thank you for all the insight, and especially for translating a lot of that into how it relates to youth baseball players. I think some people, they see a college coach or a professional coach, and they forget that you've coached youth kids at camp. You've coached your own kids. You've done those things, so you understand how it translates. Great stuff. Coach Smith, thanks. We'll be back for Q&A here in about 40 minutes, so please put any questions for him in the Q&A section. Do not put them in the chat. Put them in the Q&A. And, Rob, if you could not answer any of those right now, save those, hold on to those, and then we'll get to them in the Q&A. All right?
Sounds great.
Now, I was told by a very smart man that the number two hole is the most valuable and important piece to the lineup. Is that true, Coach Sherman?
That is true.
We're talking about offense? Okay, so a smart man. I think that was you, actually, once you said that out. I think it was you that told me that. So it's my pleasure to introduce Jeff Sherman, head coach at Flower Mound High School in Flower Mound Marcus High School in Flower Mound, Texas, right outside Dallas, Fort Worth. Highly successful high school coach, been involved with USA Baseball on a variety of fronts, and just really excited to have you here, and an OG Necton as well, right? Part of the OG Necton. Yes, sir. OG Necton crew. So shout out to the OG Nectons, wherever they're at. I know a couple of them are probably watching right now. So Coach Sherman, the floor is yours, man. Let's talk offense. Let's talk hitting.
Yeah, let's get after it. Let's go. Let me share my screen real quick and we'll get after it. All right, guys. Today we're going to talk about mastery of hitting. Now, what does that look like? Mastery of hitting. Mastery of hitting is learning how to ball strike and create results in a player development progress. So for anybody, I think the biggest thing for anybody to understand kind of what I'm trying to come across is basically creating confidence. So how do we create confidence? Because when we create confidence, it creates better hitters. So the next 20 minutes, I want to kind of get you guys to go down an alley of understanding what the zoo and what the jungle is and how to blend the zoo and the jungle. All right. So everybody kind of understands when you go to a zoo, you understand like how they eat, how they don't have to really worry about like any predators coming after them. In a jungle, you got to understand you better hunt or you're getting hunting. And so again, so I try to create an analogy for my team, for my club to kind of understand. So the zoo is basically learn the mastery of movement. So how to understand how movement is. For example, in basketball, so like shooting a three-pointer, how to create a three-pointer and then go from there, all right? And then master that movement. So how many times can I do that? Like can I hit 10 in a row, 20 in a row, and continue from there? The jungle is like that five-on-five or in that competitive environment and learning how to compete. Now, here in America, we play a lot, especially in the youth level, especially at my level in high school. They play. And then the problem is they don't create mastery in basically the zoo to create them to compete in the jungle. And so we always get that kid that always loses confidence or doesn't have very much confidence within himself, all right, to understand how to be in that jungle. All right. And so again, that's kind of my strategy of trying to create the perfect pitcher for my guys. Again, there's the OG Nectons. All right. So now how do we do that? All right. I believe that there's three levers to training. And those three levers are intensity, complexity, and velocity. And what does that mean? That can go up and down. So think of a seesaw. All right. And how do we keep that neutral through the entire time as we grow in our hitting process? So for example, intensity is the environment that you create as a coach. If you're 100% intense and you're creating competition, you're doing all that every single day, well, guess what? You're probably going to have a lot of failure within your players, which is not bad. I'm not saying that that's bad. But again, you got to have environments where they can have a way to succeed. And again, that's what I'm going to kind of talk about today. The other one is complexity. For example, like the very first one could be like hitting off the tee, hitting the back of the net. Not much complexity to it, just hitting the back of the net. That's the external cue, all right? And then moving it from there, from the complexity, now you make it a little bit tougher. Now you got bands and legs. You got you got curveball machine. You got different things and different environments to create. The next one is velocity. Again, now that's getting into the brain and how the eyes work. All right. And so I think there's three different levers that we have to like work at. And how does that work? Right. And we'll get into that here in a second. I believe this with my guys. I believe this from doing this for a while, especially in the hitting department, is I believe this creates correct movement patterns. I think that's what we try to diagnose. It creates confidence. It creates skill level to get to where they want to go. I think we learn how to ball strike. I think we get away from that all the time. We talk about launch angle. We talk about so many different things. But the end of the day is we can't swing and miss. I know all these coaches and all these people that are on here, we're getting paid money to do our job, and we better be able to teach our kids how to ball strike. Because if they're striking out, we're not going to be probably having a job where we are right now. So, again, I think we have to train our guys to learn how to ball strike. I believe this as well. I believe that if you go through understanding from the zoo to the jungle and how that off season to the in season training goes, I believe that you're going to really understand where your eyes and your brain is. I think that's very important. I think we get away from that a lot. And the next one is this why we coach? All right. I believe that we create this path for every individual, every single coach for that. I mean, that's why I'm in that's why I'm coaching, is because I want to see them progress in an upward pattern. And what does that look like? And how do we do that? All right. And I've messed up so many different times, and I've learned from my mistakes, and I've been around great people, and they've taught me these things. And this is painting that picture. This is very important. I think this is some good nuggets here. All right. So I have five circles here on the side right here. Not all five circles are the same. If I were to draw five circles, they'd all be different. All right. That's your hitters. All right. We all want to try to create these five different circles. All right. So how do we get that, and how do we blend them to be to the perfect circle for them? And that's the puzzle piece that we have to try to create for those guys. And so how do we do that? Well, I think it's really important, the debate between external and internal cues. And here's the thing is, I think from the youth level, even from the college level, I've seen it in the professional level. I've heard stories about this. All right. I believe that you have to start with external cues. I believe that you cannot understand. Now, there's a lot of myths on this, but just from where I'm at and where my arena is at Marcus Baseball, if I give a kid an external cue that does not understand movement, he's going to have zero success. But if I give him an external cue and he starts to understand the movement and understand where he's supposed to be going, for example, it could be just hitting the ball in the back of the net, external cue. An internal cue is like, get your elbow up, get your feet right, all these kind of things. I go to my son's practice. I have a 6-year-old and I have a 9-year-old. And every single day I go there, they're like, hey, get your feet right, get this, get that. Well, he doesn't understand movement. It's funny because now my son, he's a good average player, but the thing is like, I just give him external cues. Hey, hit the ball off the house right here. Boom. Hit the ball over the house right here. So he's creating that energy system to hit the ball over the house. Now, he might not have success and stuff like that. It's okay. But what I believe this, though, once they understand the internal cue, that's where the true growth happens. That's where they start understanding. That's where they start becoming really good. And you talk to a lot of professional guys, they can kind of go of how their body feels and how they swing. So here's the thing is I talked about failure and kind of backing up, and we'll get into the meat and potatoes here in a second. But you got to understand this is asking the questions of mastery of failure. I think it's very important. I think a lot of people mistake on this. I know early in my career, if one guy made one mistake, hit the ball on the top of the net, like we see in Major League, I believe that I would have that guy do push-ups or go do sit-ups or sprint, or I would get so upset in those things. But the thing is like learning how they learn. For example, if I'm doing a free throw and I hit it to the right and then the next one I hit it to the left, I want to see on that third one, do I hit it in the middle now? That's the same as in hitting. I think it goes the same way. I think that's the same in golf. I think that's in every sport. I think we have to understand where their brain is. And this is where you're trying to find. And this is what I was talking about earlier. I think we talk about like understanding where our players' mind, their eyes, and where they are. I always start with eyes. I think that's so important. So I ask them, I say, where are your eyes? But more importantly, if for my guys, I would say, hey, when did you pick it up? Where did you see it? Tunneling. Hey, did you see spin early? Did you think that ball was away? All right. And so I start there. And then if they can't answer that question and they're like, coach, I saw that really, really good. Well, then I go to the next one. All right. The next one would be, how did it feel? Well, coach, it felt like crap. Well, were you swinging a haymaker or were you swinging a quick jab up? Which one did you feel that you were feeling? Well, coach, man, yeah. That's the problem is we try to get guys overswing a lot and creates haymakers instead of quick and violent to the baseball. We'll get into that here in a minute too. So again, the last one is like, what do we need to work on? Now we're creating ownership to the player. Now we're getting into that eternal cue that they can maybe fix to get where they are. Now, again, you understand it. If you're a guy out here that has never like hit or have any understanding of how movement and hitting is, you've seen it. You know what it looks like. All right. But how do we blend it and create it? That's where the great coaches come in. That's where I believe that you can be so powerful without not even knowing how it's supposed to even look like, because you know what it looks like, because the ball's going to tell you. All right. So let's not like get carried away here of like, we got to know exactly how the swing and the swing path and matrix and all that kind of stuff. This ball will tell us and won't lie. All right. And so again, where do we start? Okay. So it's kind of funny. I was looking at my videos as I was working through this, and obviously we've been on COVID-19 for a while, and this video I made about 10 years ago. So anyways, I think it applies to this too, all right? So again, where do we start? We talked about the three levers, the low intensity, low complexity, and the low and the no velocity. I think that's where we start in the zoo. That's where we start, where it's safe. It's you go, you learn the movement, you learn how it works. You learn to be efficient and you learn to ball strike. That's my external cue all the time. Now, this is something I'm big on now. This is what we've done for the last 2 years is we start with this. We start with T, with shoes off, and we give that external cue. Hey, hit 10 in the back of the net, then you move on. And I want you to ball strike that sucker. I want you to hit that sucker hard. Okay? I think taking their shoes off, I think just to give you a little bit of a nugget on this, and we can get way into this if you want to call or talk later, but I think the biggest one is it creates you not to overswing. It teaches you to be balanced. I think you create great feel, and you create great movement patterns with your shoes off because you have these cocoons on your feet, and then those cocoons can make you do different things. It gives you false feeling. So that's why we hit with our shoes off to start with. Now, again, you might be in a different place that you can do that. But again, that's where we start. And then we go from there. We make the complexity maybe a little bit harder. We put an overload bat, bands. We might even hit a basketball. I think there's something good about the old school basketball and maybe a soccer ball and just hitting them back the net. Again, creating that. Then we'll move. Again, I said no velocity here, but I still think you've got to do a little velocity, create the timing with front toss. Again, external cue. Hit it below the L screen. Hit it right back up to the middle as hard as you possibly can. You know, overload bat now. They master that. They master this. Now we're surviving the zoo. We're doing well. All right? Now, where do we go next? Okay, now it's like the mid. I still think we're in the zoo here. So when I talk about this page, I want you to understand. I want you to evaluate where you train your guys. And I want you to think about it. Again, you don't have to do it this way. But I want you to understand, like, what you are doing. And how many times do you do it? I do these first two slides that you're about to see, and I have a third one here. I have the mid-intensity, the mid-complexity, and mid-velocity. When I talk about the zoo, so these two slides that I'm about to the last one and this one, is about 90% of what I do in my off-season program. Okay, 10% is in the jungle because I want them to master the movement. So again, I think this is where we find that sweet spot. We're starting to blend. We're starting to find the puzzle piece. We're trying to find where they can and can't go. All right, so just remember, I have 72 guys that I have to try to create these guys from varsity to freshman baseball. 72 hitters in my program. And so, again, like trying to evaluate this and do this, it's tough just to go, okay, here's your swing analytics and here you go and this is where you got to get to. No. It's different for everybody. And, again, the external cue is ball striking. Hit the ball as hard as you can in the back of the net. Again, we put a little – now we put the velocity of like – I shouldn't say it's mid-velocity here. It's something that they're going to crush. But, again, we are tuning our swing and hitting that ball back of the net as hard as we possibly can. All right? And we put a velo behind it, all that kind of stuff, so we can get to get some numbers that we can create and track it a little bit. Then from here, I think BP, that everybody thinks is BP, we're in the zoo. It's still mid. It's not high. It's not game-like. It's not there. But, again, we're tuning the swing. We're creating the swing to be where it needs to be. So, again, line drives, hard oppo, pull side, you know, power ball, whatever we want to call it, okay? Whatever, you know, it could be hit and run. Whatever it is, all right, you're giving an external cue and you're executing that external cue. Then now we can get a little bit creative. This, I still think, again, you're putting restrictions now on. Okay, this is where you hit the top of the net. Okay, hey, man, like, you're out. You know, Major League, he goes down, does push-ups, all those kind of things. Like, you got some sort of consequence here. Maybe put an overload bat, maybe a little bit restriction. My opinion here, this last one is the moneymaker. This is the one that I think blends basically from the zoo to the jungle, in my opinion. Okay, this is where it's getting a little bit – this is where the eyes are starting to work. This is where they have to guess and stuff like that. It's over here off to the right. If you can see the balls, I have 7 baseballs up there. And I'm going to tell you this, I made this. If you want to know who the worst woodworker and the most uncreative person, it's me. And if I can do that, everybody on this webinar right now can do this, all right? Or everybody that's watching this can do this. It's very simple. I got 3 ratted balls, got spray paint, and got it, all right? So, again, look on there. And so it has color-coded red, and you have color-coded blue, and then you have numbered baseballs. So therefore, like, I might, if I see a left-handed pitcher, if we see a left-handed pitcher, I might go, hey, man, right now, all right, let's see all balls off to the left side. You have to execute blue. I think there's so much to that, especially for the eyes and the brain to go, because now you have to take the red. It's a strike, but you still get to take it. I think there's so much fruit to this one, and you get the ball strike it because you see it on the field. It's awesome. I think I've seen so much fruit within my guys, and I've seen so many guys elevate to a from a, you know, we call it from a JUCO to a Division One. We've had a lot of Division One hitters, and I truly believe it's just because of the eye training and getting to the next level with just seeing and contacting and understanding it. Or you can just do, hey, we're gonna do numbers this round. So he gets up there and he hits a six and he says six. But if he hits a six and a two, we have a problem. Where's your eyes? What, you know, we go back to those questioning. All right. So again, these first two slides we do almost every day off season. Now this is where the money is. All right. When we get to season in game one, I want to be 80% here. High intensity, high complexity, high velocity. I want to sit in this area. I want my practice to be tougher in the game. I want it to be chaos. I want anytime we ever go to a situation here in Texas, they love their baseball. They love their football too, but they love their baseball, and we can travel and we'll have 2,000 people in the stands, especially in the playoffs. And, you know, we'll have crazy crowds. It's fun. It really is. And so within that, you know, we have to create that chaos, okay? Because I'm pretty sure the other team is going to be cheering when you strike out. So therefore, how do we combat that? How do we create aggression? All right? So number one is we track everything in here. This is we track from day one. Even when we do the 10% in the offseason, we track this one more than anything. I love this. Number one is velocity machine. We want to be velocity for us. We want to see 95 to 101. All right? We want to blow them up. All right, but I can't put them in there day one. I can't put them in there day two. You know, I have to create that to get them there. All right, and then they start seeing that success, and they learn to be easy. Because when they muscle up, they're not going to have success, just like anything else. All right, and we want to track it. The second one is the hardest one. I think this is the hardest one. I think this beats them up. We don't do it as much, and I don't want to do it as much either, because you want to talk about confidence killer. Here it is. Here's the exterminator right here. Is the velocity and the curveball. So you're putting one in, you don't know which one it is. You see the best fastball you're ever going to see, and you see the best slider you're ever going to see. Learn to compete. And you can create the complexity however you want. I know, you know, you can have three plates where you have one, two, and three. You can change the velocity, change the complexity every single time. And you move up according to which one you master. The last one, here's the money hole right here. This is what I challenge every single coach. This is what I figured out, and I thought it was really, really good. All right, me being a college baseball player and understanding this, the very first time that I would get assigned would be game one. So I'm sitting there, we're playing the number one team in the nation. I'm the two-hole hitter, and I look down there, and I'm like, okay, guy on first base, that's a bunt. So I'm sitting there going, okay, that's a bunt. Now I got to sit there and execute the bunt. That's the first time, no practice, no nothing, I had to execute a bunt. Well, guess what? I didn't execute it. And guess what? I got lit up because it was junior college, and they got after me pretty good. All right. And so therefore I didn't get it down. Then next thing you know, what are they going to do? Bunt again, right? I say that to you is coach pitch velocity inter squad. It creates pace. We start off every practice this way in season. We are doing something like this all the time. We are going to pitch. We're going to, it could be a coach pitch or it could be a velocity. It could be whatever. And we have to execute the bunt, the hit and run, and we want to crush it. All right. And so, again, understanding the thing. And you can do it as fast-paced as you want. Last one is live inner squad, creating the difficulty of it. Again, I think there's so much more to it of creating the what's the word I'm looking for? You're creating the approach for your hitter to go up there. Again, creating that live atmosphere. It's a little bit slower, but I think those three. If you have no idea how to even start, this is the starting kit that I would start with. Obviously, you got a pocket radar, about $100, $200, a tee, a D-bat log that I talked about with the overload. Obviously, those baseballs that I'm talking about. I want to talk about the core velocity belt. I'm not a sit there and a component or anything else like that, but I'm going to tell you, when you were talking about eternal cues, the guy that hits there can feel his swing better than any other device I've ever used for myself and for my players. And so understanding those kind of things are very important. So, again, I just want to make sure you guys understand that. All right, wrapping it up real quick. All right. how to create a mastery and intensity and complexity and is understanding that seesaw and understanding how we blend those two together. Number two is this questioning headspace. I think that's very important for us is, again, understanding where their head is, understanding where their mind is, understanding where their movement is and how they feel, and not just jumping to a conclusion right away. And then most importantly is getting into their mind is ball striking that thing, the old school hand-eye coordination. The last one is like knowing how to blend zoo to the jungle and how to go back to it. So they don't have success in the jungle and they're struggling there. Let's go back to the zoo and let's figure some things out and start with basics. Again, every single day when they walk into our campus, we're hitting with the very first drill I told you. Shoes off and we're going. And that's how we warm up. And so, again, understanding the levers and understanding how those all blend together. So, again, that's all I have today. And, again, I appreciate there's my information if you ever need anything. So, again, thanks, Bart, for, again, having me and appreciate being on.
Absolutely. Thank you, Coach Sherman. You snuck that two-hole reference in there again. So I see how much it means to you. And being a former JUCO athlete and JUCO coach myself, I also empathize with you. If you don't get it done, you don't get it done, you don't get it down. There's not 2,000 people in the stands to hear it. That coach can.
Yeah, so no one remembers the two-hole. Everybody remembers the leadoff and the three-hole, four-hole, five-hole, and six-hole. Those are RBI right. guys. But everybody remembers the two-hole that screws up. So.
That's right. Well, I mean, our three-hole hitter today, you know, one of the most important guys that we have here, Zan Barksdale. Zan is one of the foremost authorities on catching in our game today. He is the founder of Catching 101, also of the Catcher Con, the coaches convention just for catching coaches, all things catching. Zan, thank you so much for joining us. Also, USA Baseball national team coach as well. Zan, thank you for joining us today, carving out some time for us.
Andrew, man, thanks for having me on. I've got a rule that in my household, anytime USA Baseball calls, you don't say no. So I apologize. I had to cancel on you earlier in the year. I'm glad you invited me back to come on and share for a little while. So definitely appreciate you having me and looking forward to talking to guys for a little while today.
Absolutely, man. Break it down. The floor is yours.
All right, let's do it. So I'm going to be very simple for you guys. I don't have a PowerPoint. I don't have a presentation. When I talked to Coach Barman earlier, he said you've got about a 20-minute presentation, then Q&A afterwards. I thought, man, that's a lot of information over a short period of time. So I'm going to do my very best to scratch the surface on a number of areas. And then I believe everyone has my information where if you want to contact me, my email, Twitter, Instagram, whatever, I feel like I'm a pretty easy guy to get in touch with. So if you have a question that we don't get to in the Q&A afterwards, please feel free to reach out, email me. I'd be more than happy to answer your questions or help you out however I can with this stuff. So as you can see on the itinerary, we've got a few things I want to talk about today. And the number one thing I think when we're talking about developing a catcher in the year 2020 is that the landscape of amateur baseball has really changed over the past couple of years. Now, I know we've all paid attention. It's changed in the strength and conditioning world. It's changed in the pitching world and continues to change. And if you're a hitting Twitter guy, you know things are constantly changing there as well. But for the longest time, catching was very I hate to say stagnant, but there weren't a whole lot of new thoughts being introduced. And now it's exciting because the catching world is evolving. And I think a lot of that comes from the new hardware that's introduced at the big league level with the systems like TrackMan and Hawkeye. And you know, we might even eventually get to an electronic strike zone, which is another conversation for a different day. But things are changing because of these hardware and because of these systems. And what's happening at the big league level is trickling down into the amateur levels as well. So, I think it's important that we kind of take notice of what's going on and try to take a step back and look at the 10,000-foot view and just kind of try to look at it from the big picture. So things are changing. Now, there's a number of things that are good and are a few things that are bad. I think it's great that we have more people sharing information, more people experimenting, sharing ideas, trying new things. But with that said, right now it's probably a little bit harder than ever for a youth coach, simply because they don't know what to believe, what not to believe. 10 years ago, it didn't matter which catching coach or instructor you spoke to, for the most part, people were going to have very similar ideas. The top people thought that this is the way you do things. It's pretty laid out. There's a black and white blueprint. There's not a whole lot of ways to deviate and still have success. But now there's a lot of different thoughts and ideas floating around, which, again, I think is a good thing. We just have to understand how to filter through those as an amateur coach. And I know that in this webinar, we've got people that coach all the way from youth ages to upper level amateur ball guys. And maybe there's even some professional ball guys. I know we have Great Britain national team coaches on here as well. So there's people that are representing countries as well. So we've got a lot of things to talk about. And as you'll see, I think one of the first things we have to decide as a coach is where we want to focus our time and our effort. Now, that may seem like a very simple concept, but it's really important. A number of people have come out with studies over the past couple of years, and I think that we've always realized, and coaches have always said, that as a catching coach, what's the most important role of the catcher? It's to catch the ball. It's the way we receive, and then secondary is our blocking and our throwing and our other skills behind that. But I don't think that's always been what's happened. I think it's like a lot of policies you see online. They look good on paper, but they don't necessarily play out that way in the real world. So we see a shift now. We see guys that are focusing more on the receiving and putting less weight in the other things. Now, I'm going to go ahead and skip down to where we should put our time and our effort. You'll notice number three, the bullet point, I have offense. Now, I'm not going to spend any time talking about offense. We just had a lecture, and there's more time for the Q&A for that. But I do think it's important to have a conversation. I get asked by coaches and parents, you know, very frequently, they say, Coach Zan, I've got this player who's great defensively. I feel like he's better than the other guy. He's better than the player who's starting. You know, why is he not getting more playing time, this and that? At the end of the day, the catcher does have to be able to play offensive well. We have to hit. I heard Ryan Cienko, who's the catching coordinator with the Dodgers, the other day on a video. He said that if you want to play in the big leagues, you have to be able to hit. And there's no doubt about that. Excuse me. Now, I'm not going to spend my time talking about that, but I don't want to overlook it. Yes, offense is part of the game. Catchers have to be able to hit. Where we're going to spend most of our time is on the defensive portions. So the first two things that I really want to talk about are just the athleticism, kind of how that's changed and how we should build a program based around that. And then on our skill work, which is the actual receiving mechanics, blocking mechanics, throwing mechanics, and so on and so forth. So one thing that a lot of catchers and catching coaches need to implement, and we're stealing some of this information from the pitching world, is we need catchers particularly to be better athletes. Okay, we need to have more athleticism. And it starts with the arm work. Now, again, in the pitching world, we've seen bands have been around for a long time, but only in the past, you know, 5 to 15 years have they become really popular. The plyo balls, those are becoming very popular. Techniques like self-myofascial release, which would be a lacrosse ball and a foam roller. And then you have other implements like the Theraguns, the Mark Pros. All these things, I believe, should be being used by catchers to help them recover as well and improve their athleticism. One of the very big topics today in catching is, you know, the way we receive the ball, but it's also how our stances have changed. You see a lot more guys getting on one knee stance. And particularly at the lower levels, I see a lot of coaches putting catchers in a one knee stance that don't necessarily completely understand that. Okay. And when I talk about the athleticism, we want to make sure that we're building catchers who are athletic, who are able to do these things. As a guy who's watched a lot of games of, you know, 10, 12, 14, 15-year-olds, I've seen a lot of players who have potential to be really good, but they just can't even get in a good stance. Okay, they just physically cannot get in the correct posture behind the plate in order to put themselves in a good position to receive, to block, or to throw. And the biggest area that I see young catchers have issues are their hip and their ankles. So like I talked about, we've got to have an arm care program. And again, I'm not going to spend all my time talking about the exact arm care routine. It's just, I want you to start putting some time and thoughts into how you would develop yours. I like for guys to do bands before the game. I like for them to do the plyo balls after the game, along with their self-myofascial release and other things after the game for their recovery. Before the game, I really think catchers should have a dedicated hip and ankle mobility program. And again, I've got a lot of videos. I don't have time to share them all today, but I can definitely point you in the right direction if you want to message me later. But we have to get guys on a special hip and ankle mobility program. I said this when I spoke on stage a couple of years ago. I think that it's a shame that all the players stretch and prepare the same. Okay. If I'm a catcher, my body has different needs than the needs of a first baseman or a third baseman or a right fielder. Okay. I have to get into different positions. So I feel like I should prepare physically a little bit differently than those guys do. So as a coach, we need to implement a hip mobility program and an ankle mobility program with these guys. So after that, moving on past the ankle mobility, hip mobility, we also need to start doing some strength training work for these guys. Now, again, depending on which age you coach, this changes and this differs. But when I talk about strength training, what I really mean are building the forearms, the hand strength, the shoulders, so that we can receive pitches and receive pitches well, and we're able to control the ball and then manipulate it as our skill level increases. That means we're using implements like resistance bands. I've seen a lot of videos of catching coaches put Jager bands on players' wrists to give some assistance or resistance working on their moves. We're receiving heavy balls, whether it be a weighted baseball or a 1 or 2 pound plyo ball. We're doing different techniques and different strength training exercises to help build our strength throughout our receiving hand, which is also just improving our overall athleticism. Which really kind of brings me to where I'd like to spend a few minutes. And that's where, as coaches, I think it's our job to be what I call as the architect of our catcher's foundation. And so what I mean by that is it's important for you to have a firm policy in place, a firm set of procedures, a foundation of what you believe that you can relay the information to your catchers. In today's catching landscape, one of the most popular theories or ideas is that things need to be individualized. And to a lot of extent, I agree with that. I think it's very similar to a batting stance. My batting stance may be different slightly from Coach Bartman's batting stance or from any one of your batting stance, but there are going to be certain things that we do correctly. A lot of catching instructors now or coaches are teaching catchers that, hey, we're going to be very individualized. We're going to work to optimize your body the best and your anatomy and really, you know, try to hone in on your strengths. And I definitely agree with that. But again, when it comes back to implementing these things in the real world, we have to make sure that we have a firm set of foundations that the catchers all understand. So, perfect example, when I was still a college coach, every single day, I would say it's always blue in the face, our catchers knew that one of our goals statistically was to lead the league in the fewest number of pass balls plus wild pitches. I don't care who scores it, how they score it. We want as few runners advancing on balls in the dirt and balls to the backstop as possible. So that was one of the pillars. And I guarantee you, if you asked anybody that I coached to this day, if you said, hey, what was Coach Zan's philosophy? He'd say, oh man, he was nuts about not wanting balls to get to the backstop and not letting anybody advance on a pass ball or wild pitch. Okay. That was my philosophy. Our catchers knew that. You need to have your beliefs. And I think these can slightly change depending on the level that you coach at. Okay. So what I mean by that is at every level of baseball, receiving is going to be the most important job that a catcher has. Okay. Whether it's the big league level and we have the systems like Hawkeye and guys get bigger contracts now because they're better receivers. We're seeing more emphasis placed on that. Or if you're in little league, receiving and catching the ball and taking care of the pitcher component, that's going to be the most important thing that we do. But depending on the level, the other skills kind of difference, or they may vary slightly in what's more important. So, for example, anybody in this chat that coaches high school will understand that if you have a catcher that has a shutdown arm, nobody even attempts to steal, okay? Completely shuts down the running game. If in the first inning the catcher fires a 1-9 to second after the pitcher's warm-ups. Okay, so at the high school level, a strong arm is really strongly rewarded. However, at the big league level, we're seeing some shift in some things. The stolen base numbers are down. The stolen base attempts are down. The arm strength is not valued nearly as much as the receiving is. Okay, so receiving is going to be number one. And then depending on which level you coach at, it's probably going to be blocking or throwing. I think most catching coaches probably agree that blocking may hold higher value or run prevention than throwing. But again, I think that's highly based on where you are. If you're in little league and your pitchers struggle to throw the ball over the plate, then probably blocking is going to be more important than throwing at that age. However, once you change age groups and now your players are playing on the full regulation baseball field, now most catchers have a hard time either getting the ball to second base in the air, or they have to put so much air under it that it takes a long time. So the throwing and the blocking kind of fluctuate in where they lie with the most value depending on which level you are. Another thing that I think we need to focus on as coaches are, yes, what do we do to help our players have success right now, to help our team win, but we also need to try to prepare them for the next level. And most of us on this call are coaching amateur catchers. So by amateur catchers, I mean we're coaching little league guys who are getting ready for middle school ball. We're coaching middle school guys who are getting ready for high school ball. Or we're coaching high school players that are trying to prepare and trying to become college athletes. So I definitely don't think we want to get too far ahead. We want to have guys who help us win today, but our job and our responsibility is also to help these guys prepare for the next level of baseball, wherever that may be. Now, one of the things that I mentioned earlier is that there's a lot more transition in the catching world today where guys are doing things differently, okay, where I have different technique than Gary Sanchez, than Wilson Contreras, than Yadier Molina, and that's perfectly okay. Once, as a coaching staff or a catching coach, once we have our blueprint and our pillars and our foundation of what we believe is most important to us, I think it's really important that we let our guys, we let them fail some. We give them opportunity to fail and experiment. Now, ideally, we don't want to fail in game situations, so we would like to set up our practices to give our catchers opportunities to fail and opportunities to try new things. And perfect places for this are during scrimmages or during bullpen sessions. If you have a catcher who wants to start working on a right knee down stance or a left knee down stance, some of the things that are gaining in popularity right now. Let them fail, let them try during practice, but I think it is important that we watch them try some new things, okay? We don't just put them in the box and say, hey, you have to have this primary stance, your secondary stance is exactly like this. What we've seen is there are guys at the big league level who can implement different stances and different techniques in all sorts of different situations. So I am a firm believer in that we need to let our guys experiment, we need to let our guys fail, and we need to give them the right opportunities to do that. Now, I've only got a couple of minutes left, but I do want to have a couple of quick tips that I get asked a lot about receiving, about blocking, and about throwing, because I know you guys are looking for actionable items that you can go start working on your guys with immediately. And I'll start with receiving. If you want to help your guys become better receivers, one of the things you have to do is you have to start using video. If you're not videoing your guys receiving, you are behind, okay? As catchers, man, for the longest time, receiving was not fun. It was not sexy. That was not the thing you wanted to practice. You wanted to practice throwing. You wanted to practice plays at the plate. You wanted to hit. You didn't want to go through the boring receiving practice. As a coach, it's really exciting right now that receiving is becoming the cool thing to do again, okay? So one of the things that we have to do is we have to film them, and we have to show them what they're doing correctly, what they're doing incorrectly by using video analysis. We have to speak these guys' language. If we're not using video analysis for catchers receiving, I feel like we're coming up short. It's so easy to set your phone on a tripod or to buy a very inexpensive camcorder that can receive your guy, that can video your guys while they're receiving in the bullpen, that we absolutely just have to do that. Not too long ago, I put a video on YouTube for free, just teaching guys how to use some video analysis tools and how to overlay the strike zone on the screen so that it looks like a K zone in a big league game. Another question that I get very often is about blocking. I get, you know, amateur coaches and parents text me or email me and they say, hey coach, I've got a catcher who blocks really well in practice, but as soon as, you know, we get to the game, he doesn't block quite so well. What's a tip for that? And one of the tips that I would give you there is you have to make his practice, you have to make that mirror the game as much as possible, where he has to make decisions and he has to react. Too many times in practice, all we do is say, all right, we're going to block 10 balls down the middle. And now we throw 10 balls in the dirt. It's super simple. The catcher knows exactly what to expect. There's no reaction. Or we say, all right, now we're going to block 10 balls to your glove side. And we throw 10 balls over there. There's no reaction. Where in the game, they don't know when balls are being thrown in the dirt. They don't know when balls are going to be pitched in the air. And they're having to react. So while we train the mechanics of it and the movements of it, we don't train the mentality and the reaction part of it. So I would encourage you to really train the catcher's reaction as well. And then throwing, the last tip that I'll give you is I'm a firm believer that in order to make better throwers, whether it be a position player or a pitcher, guys have to have self-awareness. Okay. And over the past couple of years, I actually put together a book called The Throwing Journal where guys can go and log how they throw that day. And you don't have to have a throwing journal book per se, but your guys should log in a notebook or take notes in their phone, or maybe you put something together for yourself where guys start to write down how much they threw, how they felt, what was their recovery like, what did they do beforehand, how much sleep did they get. All these things go into what becomes a better thrower, like a stronger arm, quicker release, but also a healthier arm. And it gives them self-awareness. Okay. And ultimately at the end of the day, I feel like the self-awareness piece is taught the most through asking questions and asking players to reflect back. Why do you think your arm felt good today? Why did your arm feel great in the fall, but now we're in spring baseball and your arm's sore all the time? What was different then than it is now? I think for a long time, hitting coaches and pitching coaches have done a great job collecting video libraries of their individual player so that we can reflect on, hey, when we were doing things well, we have video of that. Now, when things aren't going so well, now we can analyze that video and compare and contrast. I think we should do the same thing throwing every day. So if you're trying to gain velocity, if you're trying to get quicker, if you're trying to just throw out more runners, I think that's something that we can all improve on. So I know that was very quick. I feel like this is probably the fastest presentation I've ever given, but I'm very appreciative of being here. And I know we have a question and answer that I'll be happy to answer any questions you guys have. And like I said, if we don't get to those, and there's something you want more information, more detail on, you can definitely find me anywhere online. I'm pretty easy to reach. But Andrew, I definitely appreciate you having me on. Let me share for a few minutes about the catching aspect. Man, anytime I get to spend a little bit of time with the USA Baseball family, it's a good day.
Awesome. Thanks, Sam. Appreciate you, man. Yeah, this is just so you know, so our viewers know, these are meant to mirror our community clinics that we typically host in person. We're on pace to have 250 of those this year all around the country. And due to the pandemic, we obviously are not meeting. So we're doing it here. And so just to get you a baseline and get you some different information in a lot of different areas of baseball, not just 2 hours on hitting, 2 hours on pitching. It's supposed to be a well-rounded experience. And we have different speakers coming at you every single time. This is our eighth clinic. You can go back through the YouTube library. Go to youtube.com/USA Baseball TV. Click on playlists, and that'll show all the different playlists of different content USA Baseball has. Choose community clinics, and you can watch every previous community clinic in its entirety. You can see them all, just like this one. This one will be up here in 48 hours if you want to rewatch something particular on it. And then the link that you got sent and that I put in the chat feature to the outlines, those are available. That's the same link every single week when we have a clinic. Those are available. So if you missed the very first clinic, April 4th, and you want to go back and watch it, you can print off that packet or have that packet up and watch a clinic at the same time. It's there for you, free of cost. Check it out. All right, let's get into the Q&A. Coach Smith is back. Coach Sherman's back. We're just going to go in order of how he spoke. We'll go to a question to Rob, a question to Jeff, and a question to Zan. And so, Rob, first one for you, really good one here. The very first question from Chris Kirkby. 11 to 13-year-olds, what does a four-day activity rotation look like? So day one, for example, day one bullpen, day two off, day three long toss, et cetera. Let's just say a four-day rotation, Rob, for a youth guy around that age period, what would you recommend?
I think there's two different things you're considering. One is if it's coming off of game or if it's just training-based, right? And so if we look at the two different opportunities, one, if it's coming off of a game, I think your 4 days would account for at least 1 day of some type of recovery work, which would be very simple for somebody at that age. It might be a little bit of band work. It might be some range of motion work for the arm and some light catch. I think your second day after that, you start to look at more of a stretching the arm out a little bit, trying to create more long toss. He might also play position most likely, so he may get back into that defensive rotation of fielding some ground balls, throwing them across the diamond. Day three, I would encourage then at that point that we would look at some sort of pitching activity, whether it's on flat ground or on a mound, depending upon how the arm felt, obviously what the workload was that he was coming off of. And then the day four would either be determined by if there's a game following and he'll have a chance to pitch in it, then probably you're talking about a lighter day of throwing. If you're talking about a scenario where he's not throwing for another couple of days, and you might be able to actually get on a mound and do some additional work if it plays itself out. If we're talking about just a non-game scenario and just something where it's strictly training, I like I like guys to get on the mound with frequency, right? And so as much as possible, I'm big frequency over volume. I think volume ultimately is what creates workload problems. I don't believe it's frequency. And so if I've got a chance, I would rather have a guy throw two bullpens in a four-day period with a reduced workload than have one bullpen in a four-day period with a higher workload. I think the challenge with that, though, is it requires us as coaches to have the organization and discipline to know exactly what we're trying to work on in that pen and not let ourselves keep going and going and going and look up and the kid's got a 65 pitch count in the bullpen because we're trying to do every pitch in his arsenal to every location to both sides of the plate. I would rather us have a very select concept for the day. And then if we go in and we're working on, let's say, day one, we're going to come in and we're going to work on just fastballs away to a right-handed hitter. We're going to go for 25. That's great. And we can take a day off the mound. Then we would come back day three. And now we may work, you know, fastballs into a right-handed hitter if we wanted to, or whatever the theme for the day was. But I'm a big believer in mound frequency, reduced volume, and the more opportunities we get to work with kids on a mound, even though it might be a shorter time span, I think is more beneficial development. Than high volume, low frequency situation.
Very good. Coach Sherman, one of our loyal listeners here, Adam from Alabama, would like to know, do you feel like it's necessary to teach shorter hitters differently than taller hitters? And if so, is there an advantage to being a shorter hitter or a taller hitter?
appreciate the question, Adam. Yes, I don't know if there's an advantage or a disadvantage. I think it's all about how the body moves and how effective they do move. And it goes back to that first basic is like how much they ball strike and then painting that picture. I do believe, you know, with your levers, with it, like from your shoulder to your wrist, I think that has a lot to do with like just presence in the box. You don't want to have like myself who's, you know, 5'9" and a half. I had to throw that half in there. You know, I'm going to be closer to the plate, you know, and I think the guy's going to be behind. Now, again, that dictates a lot to the individual and the player, the pitcher that's on the mound. It kind of varies of just box presence, but I think the box presence is going to be simple. But I think if you like look at my tall guys and you look at my short guys and you look at the major leagues, I mean, you look at Bellinger who hits balls that, you know, are absolutely crushed. He's 6'4", 6'5". And then you look at Altuve who just crushes baseballs and he's 5'5". So, I mean, you like look at these different guys that I think you have to, they all have like a different, you know, body type and different kind of execution, how they do move. And I think it all goes back to movement. And I think it's the back half of the swing going through.
Awesome. Leon would like to know, for Coach Barksdale, would you recommend an undersized mitt to develop pocket awareness or a mitt with the web removed to emphasize the actual mitt work? Which way would you go, Zan?
Good question. And, well, honestly, I'm going to take a cheap answer. I'm going to say both. I feel like training tools are very similar to golf clubs where they have a very specific purpose. Okay, so I like the undersized mitts for a number of reasons. The undersized mitts are kind of the Swiss Army knife. You can do receiving work with it. You can work your backhand. You can work your blocking. You can catch pop flies. You can do a lot of different things. The mitts that don't have the web, and particularly you're probably referring to the All-Star Equalizer, which is a fantastic mitt. I love that mitt. We use that, guys. For the guys who aren't familiar with it, it's a full-size mitt, but half the web is cut out. So what that does is when guys put those mitts on, they instantly, their focus level just increases drastically because there's no web. If you miss, the ball's going to ricochet off your mask and blow you up. So it's a great tool for helping guys focus. That type mitt, that's kind of it's a one-trick pony. That's all you really do with it. So if you're a younger coach and you're looking for the best bang for your buck, I think an undersized mitt, you know, say a 27-inch or maybe even a 29-inch, All-Star makes a great one called the Focus Framer. I use that. I think that's the most versatile by far. But if you do have a little bit more room in the budget, also picking up an equalizer might be a good idea too.
Awesome. Very good. Thank you, sir. Coach Smith, is there a pro – Ryan Leonardton would like to know, another Texas guy here, is there a program or anything specific you use for self-awareness and behavior recognition?
Yeah, that's a great question. I know Coach Leonardton, actually. He's an awesome dude. I've known him for a while. So great question there. And I would say that for me, when you talk about developing mental awareness and the mental game itself, I think there's a couple of different things. As a coach, I think a lot of it you can design to develop the mental game is environmental, right? How you set your practices, how you set your bullpens, the environment you create, can that create challenges for guys and give them opportunities to have little mini success and failures within the framework of a scrimmage pitching environment? And then you can start to work and navigate those things. I think the biggest thing that I try to do is talk with our pitchers, not about necessarily changing how they feel, because I think that's a human element, right? I don't think we can change how we feel. I think we have to recognize how we feel and then be able to have a plan of action to deal with those emotions that come with you know, being frustrated or being mad or being scared or being apprehensive or any of the things that go through. And I think if you're developing a plan to work with your players from a mental standpoint, I think the first barrier to breakthrough is that there are no bad feelings, right? That they're all real. There are no bad feelings, but understanding how to manage and navigate those feelings is where the game's won and lost. You might be scared, right? And that doesn't make you soft. That doesn't make you, you know, lesser of a player. If you can recognize the anxiety and the fear that comes with a competitive moment, you can maybe make some adjustments to navigate and work through that situation and find success. Even though you might be out there doubting yourself and second guessing yourself, that's a real feeling, but navigating that feeling is ultimately what matters and what probably has the most direct correlation to outcomes and results.
Great, great stuff. Coach Sherman, our friend Tom Succo out in Arizona, a great friend of USA Baseball and contributor. I would like to know, how much time do you spend on working breaking ball? And do you work on approach with the breaking ball, two-strike approach, et cetera?
Absolutely. I think that's a great question because, you know, I think we do concentrate a lot on velocity and we do on a ball that's straight. In our off season, when I talk about the 90% that we're training in the jungle and the zoo, and 90% in the zoo, I apologize, is we do see a lot of spin. And I do want to create the spin, and I want them to get used to that spin. And we start easy, and then obviously we make it as difficult as we can. I talked about the three different plates, and I want to make sure that, you know, we got the meatball, we have the one that's the tough two strike, and we have the foul off. I believe this as you know, Coach Smith was talking about with pitching and stuff like that. If we can get his ace, if we can get his best pitcher, and we can foul off his best pitch and come back with maybe a secondary pitch, I feel like we can win and we can dominate maybe hopefully later in that game as we're trying to attack that guy. And so, again, we try to preach that. I try to preach that as much as I can to our guys is understanding that. Now, we talk about internal and external cues with the two-strike approach. I think what we do is knowing who the pitcher is. If it's left-handed, right-handed, velocity, slider, sinker, whatever those things are, we try to match that in all offseason. I try to give them as much information of how a pitcher is going to pitch. And then we create that in the jungle. And then within that, I want our guys with two strikes is basically we're going to since I have a lot of guys that are listening on here, we swing at curveballs in the dirt. We try to explain that. That's for my competition guys. But, no, we try to be late to the fastball. We want to be late to the inner half fastball, outer half fastball. We want to absolutely blitz. And we want to hit that and ball strike that ball as hard as we can. And our focus is opposite field gap. And so we're trying to create. And so now it goes back to the eyes. We want the eyes to track a little bit later. All right. And, again, we want to be as smooth and as easy to it as well. The best way not to be with two strikes is not get to two strikes. So that's kind of the goal is attack early and be aggressive.
Perfect. Very good. Coach Zan, Tran Phong from Virginia would like to know, what's the proper pre-pitch glove position? Is it extended or more relaxed and closer to the body with glove on the ground, which I know is a new trend that is everyone working down to up, working from the ground up. So what do you think is proper pre-pitch glove position? Extended and more relaxed, closer to the body with the glove on the ground?
Good question, and I'm going to skip around this answer too and kind of give you a generic answer. I'll say there's two things that need to happen. Everybody's going to be slightly different, but in my opinion, two things need to happen. Number one, we have to be relaxed, okay? It has to be a comfortable movement. The guys are comfortable with it. If it feels forced, if you teach a guy, hey, we're going to do this, it just looks awkward. It looks uncomfortable. It's not smooth. It's not going to work for him. So I think one is we have to let guys figure out what works naturally within their own body. With inside the main parameter of number two, which is we have to work from the bottom part of the zone up, or maybe even from the ground up. You see a lot of guys in the big leagues now that are, some are tapping their mitt on the ground, some are scraping the ground, working up. There's guys that have a lot of success receiving from extension deflection. Okay, if I can get on here. So extension would be started, and flexion would be here. Some guys receive extension deflection. Some guys receive flexion to extension. And that's going to be a skill that is very player dependent. Again, if we're watching guys in the big leagues right now, there's guys that do each. It's hard to say there's one right way or wrong way, but I will say it seems much easier to teach guys to catch flexion to extension where they're reaching out and lifting the ball through the bottom of the zone. So again, I know that's not an exact answer for you. So I apologize for that, but I really do firmly believe that you have to work within a guy's, whatever his comfort level is, and then you have to be below the ball. So, you know, we used to teach the half moon and guys just relax, but they would still drop the mitt and come up. Now we see guys starting below the ball for sure, with some even starting on the ground. So I wouldn't rule that out. I would experiment with guys, even though it's against things that were taught for a long time, starting with their mitt on the ground and working the way up, especially for a pitcher that can control the bottom part of the zone, can be a very good thing.
Great, great. Thank you, Zan. While we're on hot button topics, let's go back to Rob Smith. Let's go to the pitching guy. And so I'm sure you know what we're going to ask now. Varun Agnish would like to know, is it player's age or player's physical development which dictates weighted ball use?
Great question. I generally would go with physical development over age. I don't think age necessarily, it can be a broad benchmark, you know, which we utilize even to categorize players, right? And what leagues they play in or what level they get to play in, their age certainly dictates that. But I think certainly physical development, rate of growth, all of that plays a big role in anything that you do. And so I'll use the example of, you know, when people see kids in the Little League World Series throwing a breaking ball, right? And you hear a lot of uproar about that. But what they fail to realize is that kid's far more advanced than your standard youth pitcher. Right. That's why he's in that stage. That's why that team probably has gotten to that route. He's much taller. He's much more developed. Just his own body chemistry has changed at a much rapid pace than other kids. And so I think it's less about age and more about gauging the physical development and having an understanding of weighted ball use and how it applies. I will, however, say this, that I think as I talked about those stages of development for pitchers, I think there's so many more other things that a pitcher can focus on at that age range that probably would not have them at weighted ball use yet. I think there's lots of other things that they can probably spend their time and pull their energy to on the development side of things before I would probably get to that point, in my opinion.
Excellent. Excellent. Where are we at here? Coach Sherman, once again, friend of the program, Rich Moretta, would like to know, many youth coaches do not have the time high school coaches do to practice. What skills or drills do you recommend youth coaches spend most of their time on with hitting? So let's just say you're a youth coach, you get one practice a week, you've got 30 minutes set aside for hitting. If you could pick the best, give me your best three hitting drills for youth baseball coaches on a limited time right now, Coach Sherman.
Yeah, that's a great question. I do a lot with our youth here locally and we talk about those things because there is something to do with the, you know, with a coach in America with that is a volunteer coach where they're coming in from 5 o'clock and they're trying to get a practice plan by 5:30. And then they go and they have very limited time. They have a field that's an hour and a half. And like, how do you utilize that and create development with that? Great question. I think it's very important that one is like going back to the basic of ball striking, like, make that in your mind and understand the zoo to the jungle. If you have like just concepts in there, I think that'd be really good. I think the number one, just for me, especially in the youth level, like young guys all the way up to mine is like, you got to remember, like when they get to college, like their skill set's done. It's over. When they get to me almost, it's done. You got to remember the prime age is between, you know, 8 to 14. So again, like understanding how their body moves. So I'm a big believer. And I talked about it at the very beginning about the shoes off and hitting. Like legitimately if they have a cage or have something like that because they learn how the body moves. Again, Zan just talked about like how to be easy, you know, easy to the baseball and stuff like that. It creates that itself, all right? When you have a tee there, they're not going to hit the ball off the their shin or their maybe. But at the end of the day, it's a whole lot safer doing it within that and hitting a ball off, like just learning how to ball strike. I think just creating elements of like at the same time is like a little front toss and having target you know, practice. I think creating something that they have, something that they can master, like 10 of 10, 8 of 8, 9 of 9, will create the opportunity of them going and doing it in multiple places. So they have like six sets. So I would, if I was like doing a youth program, I'd have a tee over here. They're hitting off the cage over here. We're doing front toss with maybe wiffle balls. And then over here, we might be hitting live the opposite direction and protecting players. So I would have it where they're getting as many reps as they can and then creating a mastery within that.
Perfect. Okay, owner would like to know, and I'm going to answer this question myself. How do we as coaches fight the internet that tends to focus on launch angle versus making contact or throwing velocity versus location or hitting the target? And I'm just going to answer that myself as Andrew Bartman, not an official USA Baseball stance, but the way you fight the internet is you go coach. And you go coach how you believe, what you believe in. You have some pillars in hitting or some pillars in pitching that you firmly believe in, that you have researched and that you believe to be true. When you yell at and yell over other people on the internet, you look as bad as you think they do. Okay. So if you could do me a favor, and if you don't want to fight on the internet, then get away from the internet and go spend your time coaching. And there are plenty of books that are not on the internet that you could read to make you a better coach. And there are ways that we can grow as a baseball community. You don't have to agree with everyone in order to be on the same team. I had some teammates that I really didn't like, and I know I had some teammates that probably really didn't like me for various reasons. But at the end of the day, we're on the same team. And so we're all on the same team of wanting to grow the game of baseball around the world. And so my advice to you would be to, if you don't want to see the fights on the internet, then get away from the fights on the internet and go out and just pump some more good into the world of baseball, because everybody knows we need it. So that's my soapbox for the day. We'll get the focus back on our presenters here moving into session two. Zan, Jeff, Rob, great dudes, great information. Thank you so much for sharing today, and we appreciate you taking your time on this Saturday away from your families, away from whatever else you had going. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks, Bart. Appreciate it, guys.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, we've got two more minutes before the great Liam Carroll joins us. He may be turning the computer on here in a second. I want to tell you a little bit more about our USA Baseball resources that we have available. You can head on over to usabdevelops.com. That is our development section of our website. You can go to usabaseball.com and see all of the great history of the national team, NTIS tryouts, all that good stuff. You go to usabdevelops.com, and you can see everything that we have to offer. All 100% free of charge. There's a mobile coach app with color-coded drill library, intermediate, beginner, difficult. There's sample practice plans. There's drills. USA Baseball's medical team just put out an outstanding return to play, not protocol, but suggestions for return to play. That's available on the development website. We have the Fun at Bat program. If you are an elementary school PE teacher, or you know an elementary school PE teacher, we want to have Fun at Bat in their school. They'll get a free equipment kit, a free curriculum that has been approved by Shape America, along with some great books about character building and team building that the class can read. It's really, really, really good stuff. Reaching 3.5 million kids all around the world, in England, in America, in Mexico, and I believe Brazil. We're moving into some other markets as well. So really, really good stuff, the Fun at Bat program. And our certification program. We have a free three-level certification through USA Baseball, A, B, and C. Level C requires you to attend a coach's clinic, and due to the pandemic, this one right here will count towards that, provided you stay on longer than, 15 minutes. You spend a good chunk of the time with us today, because we do check the minutes report from Zoom versus who registered. So please check that out. Coaching certification, it's a great way to grow as a coach. There might be some stuff you already know. There might be some stuff you didn't know. There might be some stuff that you already knew, but it's explained in a different way. Please check that out. That's courtesy of my good friend Jeff Roden with the Diamondbacks, who told me that about our certification program. So check that out. And again, all clinics are posted 48 hours after they're done to the USA Baseball YouTube account. So please jump on and check that out. Other special notice to our friends tuning in from Spanish-speaking countries, or anyone who, if you know a baseball coach or baseball person who speaks Spanish, this upcoming Wednesday, we're going to have a very special coaches clinic. It's going to be delivered entirely in the Spanish language. We have two major league, big league staff members going to be here. Julio Rangel with the Rangers, who is the Rangers big league pitching coach, originally from Panama. We got Joe Espada, the Astros big league bench coach from Puerto Rico. He is going to be with us. Mervil Melendez, the head coach of Florida International University. Christian Frias with the Orioles. We've got Olan Ortiz from Bethany College. And Jaime Del Valle, who runs the Diamondbacks Academy in the Dominican Republic. So if you don't speak Spanish, I want you to get out of your comfort zone, challenge yourself next Wednesday night, join us and see how baseball is a universal language. And if you do speak Spanish, we want to provide this same service to your country, to your community, no matter where that may be. Baseball, again, is a worldwide language, and we just want to keep providing as much as we can to everyone who plays it and coaches it. So you've heard me talk enough. I am done. It is my great pleasure to introduce my very good friend, Liam Carroll, the manager of the Great Britain national team. And, man, there's so many other things I could tell him about you, Liam, but I'm not going to. But he's going to share some great info with us today. Thank you so much. We are reaching across the pond here. You're coming at us from London, yes?
Just outside, yes, sir.
Just outside London, just outside of the high rent district. Liam is checking in with us because he's a baseball guy. So thank you so much, Liam. You have the floor.
So I'm good to share my screen here.
Absolutely. Off and rolling.
I appreciate it, Bart. And I do get this more often than you might think. You guys even play baseball across the pond. And in the immortal words of Jake Taylor, we do. And we've got uniforms and everything. So bear with us as we talk about some British baseball. Great Britain baseball specifically is our national team's program from 12U on up. And as we talk about practice planning today, some considerations for you to keep in the back of your mind. I agree with this. I think that practice should be harder than the game for the most part, but I think we've got a broader responsibility because practice changes the world. For the better or for the worse, practice changes the world. I think we should crush what we expect to be good at, but I also think that we need to accept that we can't be good at everything. And you can certainly save yourself some sleepless nights the sooner you come to terms with this. And I agree for the most part that that practice is for us as coaches, and the games themselves are for the players to go out and enjoy, but that's something that we need to earn. And there's a big part of that in putting time into planning. And just as an aside, we had a practice not too long ago on the same day that there was a terrorist attack in London, and players chose to practice. They came to practice, and that kind of really hammered home to me the importance of practice planning. And finally here, while I do love this quote, this idea that there are no always or nevers in baseball, let me give you one never, and that's to make sure that the inspiring quote on your plan is not the most inspiring part of practice. If we look here at practice as being above the waterline, that's what our players actually experience. That's the impact that we have on them. Whether they enjoy it or not is below the waterline. That's the planning, and it can be very daunting. There's so much information out there, especially on the internet, and that was touched on just a few minutes ago with how much info there is. And sometimes it's forced on us, I think, as coaches, quite frankly. And we can guide you through this and make it a little bit less daunting by looking at some guiding principles. And those include developing a system, developing a framework, working on your design, and ultimately being flexible. And system is really quite simple. It's just plan, do, and review. And that's something that exists in all kinds of industries. And if you're not a full-time baseball coach, you might be plan, do, and review in your day job. And we could be planning on a daily basis, a weekly basis, a monthly basis, and some of us even planning on an annual basis. And for us, we look at the language a little bit differently. We start with a cycle. That's our year, which is divided into phases. And within our phases, we have weeks and we have days. Our cycle runs from October to September, and we could actually shorten that up a little bit. We start in October, and the cycle ends whenever our players go away to their tournaments. So, for example, European Championship, and those are usually between June and September. Our phases begin with individually focused activities. In January, we start to incorporate team implementation. April and May is more focused on evaluation before we're in the fire once tournament season arrives. And I think this is the nature of the national teams program and maybe some of your environments where there's all kinds of weeks. We have lots of weeks where there's zero contact. Our players are dotted around the country. We might only see them once a month in the winter. And then all the way through to tournament season where we see them every day. And like that, our days are very different too, from zero contact to practices. And then once again, if we're in tournament settings, they will be under our care for 24/7. The do is out for this presentation. You've got some great information from some phenomenal coaches today. So we'll focus more on the plan and the review. And starting with plan, this might be the most daunting thing. Where do we even start? And I think you should start with your way. And we hear about the Yankees way or the Angels way. And we have the GB way. And it begins with a mission, which is to inspire, to develop, and to perform. And each of those mission element has a vision that's attached to it. And certainly at the national teams level, we are focused on performance, the older the players get especially. So we need to understand that our performances are informing our practices, and in turn, our practices drive performance. But right now we're at 30,000 feet, and there's not much on this slide that's going to actually help me plan a practice. So we can descend down to 15,000 feet, and our playing philosophy is very important because we know when we win our playing philosophy, we always win. Our goal as a program is to just up the winning percentage. And what we have here is the beginning of something that threads a needle throughout our program, which is a commitment to process over outcome. And all we need to do to begin our practice planning is to add a layer here. We need to practice all of the ingredients of our playing philosophy. If we reflect a little bit, I think if you attend any webinar, any clinic, read any book about practice planning, it's going to tell you you need to set objectives. And from 30,000 feet, we've done that. It's also going to say that you need to identify and establish a calendar. And again, at 30,000 feet, we've done that. Something that I think can help you take your practice planning from good to great is to incorporate implementation checklists into your planning. And this is especially important if you are a head coach or director of your program. And there's myriad things we could include. A good place to start, I think, are team aspects. So if we look at an example here from our defensive playbook, these are the things that we need to implement during our calendar. And as we list these things down, it becomes easier to think about distributing things throughout our cycles, throughout our phases, throughout our weeks, and ultimately in our daily practices. Another example we could look at for infield play. As an infield guy, I know that through the course of a year, I need to cover all of these areas with my players. And this will also inform our practice distribution because I know that we can't incorporate the team defensive aspects we just looked at until I've implemented certain of these things. Here's a very straightforward example of a implementation checklist. Using team defense as the example, we're just listing everything that we plan to implement. We're going to be clear about who's responsible for it. We're going to incorporate some basic conditional formatting. Red means we haven't got there yet. Green means we've implemented it and things went well. Yellow means it needs to be reviewed. And I think an important column here is the last update so we can keep track of the things that we are implementing. We can take a deeper dive too. This is a more advanced example of an implementation checklist. This time we're using infield play as the example, and all we've done is add our implementation timeline. This is time sensitive. You're going to have to put some time in, but I think it's worth it in the long run. And so there's no conditional formatting on here yet. It's just a case of if it's green, that is when we plan to implement something. Yellow means we're gonna focus on it, but it's already implemented, and red means we're taking a break from it. We can advance this with some conditional formatting. So for example, right here, if we implemented something and we were happy with its implementation, we're gonna conditionally format it with the green cells. It was on the money. Meanwhile, if we implemented something and we weren't happy with it, things to go back to, it's just simply a review. And it's important that we continue to check back on our implementation checklist. And we do this in two ways. One is with logical times for review. So if we do break for our throwing program over the winter to give the guys some time off from throwing, the logical time to review our program is when we come back. Another way that we review is, if we look at tags here, we implemented in October. It was great. We came back in November a month later, and we just weren't good at it. I was a bad coach on that day, whatever the case might be. Then we need to make sure we're updating our implementation checklist so that we've got a review point. A note here, and I'm certainly cognizant, and I've been there myself, that not everyone works with a coaching staff. But this will be applicable if you're solo. You're just going to be kicking your own teeth rather than having somebody kick them in for you. But it's important that we're crystal clear about when we intend to do things. So, for example, here, if I'm planning to implement fly ball communication in March, I need to make sure all of my assistants know that's the goal, so that they can do their job prior. And I've seen it so many times where we try to implement something that involves multiple position groups, and it's not been communicated well, and your assistant coaches are angry at you, or like I said, if you're running solo, you're angry at yourself. Moving on to review, and there can be a lot of noise here. This again speaks of just how much information there is out there. Maybe you feel like you're happy with your practices, but you learn something new. You go to a convention, you go on a clinic, and you're just really not sure about your next practice plan. You could also get greedy. I mean, if you're winning, if you feel like your practices are going really well, you want to add and add and add, and there's just lots of noise. There's a fundamental question you can ask yourself. Did you meet your objective? And I think that can give you tremendous clarity in the review process. And an example, a very straightforward example, if we plan on a given day to ensure that our players understand the difference between a forehand ground ball and a backhand ground ball, we need to ask ourselves, did we successfully implement it that day? And it can provide clarity. And here are some other examples. Did we win? Did we win games? That's important for us. We talked about that earlier. Did we win our team goals? So for us, that would be our playing philosophy. Whether it's in practice or in games, did we win player goals? Whether that's implementing the forehand and the backhand or a specific metric that we're working towards. We should also incorporate feedback, which we'll come back to in a little bit. And then finally, as we do all of our reviewing, we're going to have an absolute ton of information that we need to balance, and we need to ask ourselves the fundamental question, what's important now? And once we do that, we can start to close the feedback loop, and we're back to planning. Here's a way that we look at our performances to inform practice, and this will be a short-term example here. So it's a little bit gaudy here. There's lots of information, but green is good and red is bad, and this is a specific team and a specific tournament. And if we focus on these three freebies that we lost, these are the reason we lost that game. I'm certain of it because we've done so much work investigating our playing philosophy as it relates to wins and losses. So in the short term, we need to address these things in practice to get better. And I think so many of us work in tournament settings where it's even more powerful because you know you're going to play the same team again, and they're going to come at you. If they think they've exposed your weakness, they're going to come at you. So we need to attack these weaknesses. But it's also important to always consider sample size in our review process. So we need to zoom out sometimes. And this now is every freebie category across our age groups for the last 4 years. And when we zoom out, we can identify some different priorities for our program as a whole, and for that matter, also for each age group. In terms of feedback, I think as coaches, we are inclined towards reviewing, and we give each other lots of feedback. And I'm not going to spend too much time here. What I'd encourage you to do that might be a little bit different is to incorporate player feedback into your practice planning reviews. And a simple way that we've done that with our academy that runs through the winter is by asking the kids, did they enjoy practice? And if 10 players come back out of our group, we generally have 10 to 20 that show up. If a bunch of them show up, or excuse me, they report back that they had a 1 or a 2, they really wanted to leave, then that's on me. I need to look in the mirror. Equally, if it's just one player and everyone else is reporting 5s, they love practice, then that just raises some red flags for that player, and we need to look at their circumstances individually. And then finally, in terms of review, once a year, I suggest a bigger audit, and it really can be as simple as looking at what you want to stop doing, start doing, and keep doing within your practices. Our framework are macro components of planning. And this is, when I started coaching, this is all I thought there was to practice planning. It's the piece of paper that gets posted and it looks great. And we still strive to have a great practice plan format. It's the plan itself, what it looks like and what goes on it. And I do think it's important, especially if you're sharing it with your players. More important is that we are maximizing everything that we have, our time, our space, our equipment, and our strengths individually as a coach, whether we're running solo, I'd say, especially if we're running solo, and even if we do have a coaching staff. This is my go-to format. The reason I love it is that we can block this out. So if I go through things here, let me back up a little bit. I know some of us might not have pitchers, catchers, infielders, outfielders, so we can easily modify this format with groups. I've been there myself so many times where they're too young, they're too new to the sport, whatever the case is. But the reason I like it is we can easily block this out for when players are working together in their groups or their positions and when they're working separately. At the bottom, we can add as much detail as we want to, but I would note that we should empower assistants, if we do have them, to put together their own plans for their own areas and really encourage them to own their own coaching. Here's another example, really similar in structure, but we've added these coach assignments columns. And in this setting here, it's much like a camp style environment, which we do throughout the winter. And we're going to have a lot of players and a lot of coaches. And we want to make sure the coaches know what they're doing. And I think the more coaches you have, the crazier things can get. It's important that we are crystal clear with what their responsibilities are. Also on this particular plan, and I believe this is important for coaches, or important to us, to develop a complete ball player, we need sound technique, sound approach, and become our own best coach. So guess what? That goes on the plan. We've talked about objectives. These are the objectives for the given day, so they go on the plan. Been there, don't have the printer, don't have time to print. This works too. Ultimately, while we do strive to have great formats, ultimately it's about what goes on it. Some other things we do. An individual plan. We'll incorporate this as much as we can, and each player has two rows. The first is individual focus areas for that day, and the second row are drills and cues, et cetera, that they should be using to focus on their improvement. And then I love these mini whiteboards. We spend a lot of time indoors. We dot these around the space. In this particular example, it is just outlining what we're doing at each station, but it could be a cue, it could be a scoreboard. It really helps us to maximize our time. We don't have to go back and forth to check with the master plan. And we also, and we love this, and you might not be for it. It may depend on the age of your players, but it can really involve your players in the development process. Some notes to wrap up on the framework. It's a perfectly valid opinion, but I don't necessarily subscribe to the theory that we have to do the important things first. I would ask, if it's not important, why are we even doing it? I think the most important thing as you look at your framework is just to apply logic. Transitions can be a bugbear of mine. For example, if you want to spend 15 minutes taking ground balls and you assign 15 minutes of your practice plan for it, you're immediately dead in the water if you spend a minute talking at the beginning and a minute talking at the end. Make sure you include transition time in your practice plan. And in terms of how to coach, and this ties into the transitions, we've got to be clock cognizant and aware of how much we're pushing and how much we're pulling. And we don't want to be there. I've seen it so many times. We start the stopwatch during a coach assessment, then they have 15 minutes and 10 minutes and they're still talking. Moving on to design, micro components of your plan, and kudos to you, I'm preaching to the choir, go to school. My biggest point here is, if you are going to put something on your plan, you better understand it fully and know that it's a good fit for your program. We looked at this slide earlier. This is process over results, which helps us to plan practices in terms of design, but we'll just look at it in a slightly different way. And the example is a rundown. We are in a pickle in a game, and hopefully we are going to execute our rundown. What that should mean in our practice environment is that we practice rundowns in game-like scenarios with base runners. Probably before we do that, we're practicing drills. So we'll take the rundown apart. We might take the base runners away. And before that, we should be implementing a system for rundowns. Ours simply is called the rules of the rundown. Where I think a lot of coaches early in their careers may fall down is that they haven't practiced all of the required skills before they jump into the rundown. And if you want to be up at the penthouse with Coach Bart, the penthouse of coaching, make sure that you are breaking the skill down fully before you get into a rundown. Another example of this that I see is we go ahead and work on first and third defense and a rundown happens and we mess it up and we blame the kids. That's our fault if we haven't already implemented our system and practiced all of the relevant skills. Basically, what we're talking about here is progressions. And I think as coaches, we love progressions. I love progressions, whether it's an infielder going from kneeling to game speed ground balls. We need to understand that they're born out of backwards design. We start with the desired outcome, whether that's learning to field a ground ball or winning a tournament. And we need to go all the way back, figure out all of the steps required, and then ultimately figure out what step one is. The last point here in terms of design, especially as I've referenced, it can be murky. There's so much information. You can't go wrong if you are maximizing the windows of opportunities we have within long-term athlete development. And I know USA Baseball does a tremendous job here with their LTAD model. And it's really simple here. You don't have to make this complicated. If you, for example, you're coaching a seven-year-old, there is a window here for speed development, and it can be including some speed activity. We're rounding third, Bart. We're getting there. Flexibility is simply methods and tools to facilitate the execution of your plan. And every coach, whether it's a big league coach or a little league coach, needs to develop a menu of drills and activities.
You're speaking my love language here, Liam. In and out. You're speaking my love language right there. I love it.
When we're lifted off this this lockdown, we'll go together. How about that?
Excellent. I love
it. Maybe we'll get an apartment together outside of an In and Out. Your drills and activities, or your menu, should have your tried and trusted, your go-to, the ones that are your favorites that you know will have impact, and also your player favorites. You can't be flexible without variety, and we should copy and steal everything, but we need to be cognizant that if we don't understand it, it's not going to be successful. And I think this menu is especially important. If you have a real job and you're scrambling to get from work to the field, I would suggest in advance you invest your time in the framework. And if you've got a menu, then you can just pick and choose based on what you want to do that day. We should also develop a menu of constraints. And this is especially important, I think, for the coach who's running solo, the coach who's got a group of players with multiple ability levels, and you have to do the same drill with all of them. And if we look at the pin placement here, that's going to be more challenging for some players than for others. If the player who's got it is getting bored, all we need to do is put the pin somewhere else. And now we've given them a new challenge. And for the player who is struggling, maybe not as experienced, all we need to do is put the pin right there in the middle. We are all, I think, as an industry, as a community, committed to superior planning. But don't be a slave to your plans, okay? This is a space that doesn't normally have ping pong tables in. And we've ended up having some of our best practices in there when there's been ping pong tables, because they're not supposed to be there. And it keeps us on our toes. So we get into the space at 6 o'clock. We're already late because we've got to clean up, but we've ended up being flexible and adaptable and having great plans. Let me leave you with this one right here. Invest time in planning practices that capture and inspire your players' imaginations so that they want to come back tomorrow. All right. Thank you, brother.
This is where we slow clap, Liam. Great stuff, man. Great, great stuff. That's the manager of Great Britain's national team, Liam Carroll. Hopefully, USA Baseball and Great Britain will be locking horns in some tournament sometime soon, whenever we allow international competition again.
The classic.
Yes, hopefully. Hopefully, sir. Thank you very much. Coach Carroll will be back in the Q&A with us. So please, any questions for him or for practice planning, put them in the Q&A, the Q&A button down below. So this next presenter is one that I'm very excited to bring to you all. Rob Fournier is the head coach at Wabash Valley College, a Division I junior college in Mount Carmel, Illinois. Finished the season ranked number one in the country, the abbreviated season ranked number one in the country, third at the JUCO World Series a couple years ago. And for point of reference, I'm excited to have him on today because he is one of my best friends and was a mentor of mine, still is a mentor of mine. We talk daily. Rob gave me my first job out of college. I was his pitching coach for 3 years. So I've seen the inside of that office a whole lot. I've spent a whole lot of time inside that office. Grew me into the man, the coach I am today. So, Rob, thank you so much for everything, and thank you for joining us today. And take us through your base running routine, which I know you've had a ton of success with. I've seen it firsthand.
Well, first of all, I just want to say thanks to you, Coach Bartman. It's more of an honor now watching you grow and do the things that you do is pretty cool. So, just wanted to get into some base running stuff and talk about why I love it so much. I mean, I think it's. I talk about this all the time, but it's an equal opportunity employer. So I get a kick out of that. But, you know, it takes no talent. You be big, fast, slow, whatever the case may be. And it's a great situation for anybody to have a chance to be good. So I think that's the cool thing about base running is it doesn't take talent. So one of the things that we love to talk about base running is how important it is to the game. So I think there's a lot of parts that we overlook. And I think that I learned that early on in my career coaching is that, you know, you better have a system in place if you want to win close games and you want to further your offense. So, you know, some of the things we'll be talking about today are basically just our core beliefs. Getting out of the box, leads and rules at first base, just kind of the outline form. Advancing on ground balls, leads and rules at third base. You know, kind of a practice plan, which is a square drill that we talk about and we'll go over at the end of towards the end of the presentation. So, but pretty cool stuff that I've learned through, you know, my ranks of listening. And I think that's important to be a very good listener. So our core beliefs are know and dominate our rules. I think our rules are so important that for us to be accountable, we have to do something to make sure our players know how important it really is. So we do tests. We do pop quizzes. We do competitions with charts. Different things that I can show you later on in our presentation and Q&A and stuff like that that we can give to you. So it's pretty cool that we can go over different techniques most importantly, we don't give away outs. So those are some of our core beliefs. I think it's really important that we understand that you get confidence by knowing the rules. So those are big things that I like to talk about. So getting out of the box, getting right to it, we're digging into some things. And, you know, hard 90s is such a cool thing to talk about. Everybody talks about it, but do you really believe in it? And so if you really believe in it, you chart it. And I think that's something that we do all the time is, you know, we chart the hard 90s. If somebody's running a 4-3, okay, so that's a pretty good place. I expect them to do it practice and our scrimmages, whatever the case may be. So our hard 90s are an absolute, that equals playing time. I think it's important that everybody understands that if you're not going to give us a hard 90, that's a mentality. It's a reflection on a program, reflection on yourself. You're going to be sitting next to one of our assistant coaches. So it's a non-negotiable. It's something we don't debate. It's an automatic. It's an absolute. So those are things that before we get started to getting out of the box, the technique, we need to make sure we're clear with that. So we chart everything in our scrimmages. But the hard 90s, as far as getting out of the box, we'll just start and we'll go around the horn. But at the home plate, we like to create an angle early. And there's different reasons why we like to do this. The first reason is I really think that by getting out of the box early and creating that angle, I think that you get a better chance, giving you more time to evaluate if you can take stretch it into a double or whatnot. So I think it creates a better angle towards second base. So those are a couple of things as far as technique that we talk about all the time. So, you know, as far as the reading the ball off the bat, you got to have a good idea of the mentality of, hey, that's got carry or it doesn't. So you know, basically what we're talking about there is when we get out in front and we start to drive our eyes to second base, we'll have a better idea if we can, you know, stretch into a double or not. So the other thing we talk about is a ground ball. Our head is up. We see flight. It's obviously on the ground. We drive our eyes to the front part of the bag. And that's the biggest thing that a lot of people don't understand is we're trying to find the front part of the bag. The only way humanly possible to do that is follow it with our eyes. So we drive our eyes to the front part of the bag. And I think it's really important that, that we understand that. So we also break down. We look to the right, look to the left. We're going to go through this in a simple video. Didn't have a lot of players around to do some damage there. So don't laugh at myself here, but I tried to do the best I could here.
Okay, gentlemen, we are covering all bases. All we're working on this segment is some simple technique work. The first thing we're going to go over is being really aggressive out of the box, thinking two. And our simple technique is get out early, all right, and getting online towards second base, okay? So that is our most important thing, is identifying ball flight, if it is a ball in the gap, all right? And obviously, if that takes place, we're dominating.
Nice simple practice work. We're simply reading the ball off the bat, getting out early, getting out big. Our head is up so we can see flight. We can allow ourselves to have more decision-making time. So as we identify that we're going to take a chance for a double, we're going to hit the inside part of the bat.
Gentlemen, as we establish that we're in line towards second base because we got a big round here, we are out early. When we attack the inside part of the bag, our head and our eyes are driving down to the bag before we get there. As soon as we dominate the bag, head goes up, pop the head straight up, okay? Then we can still make a decision and get as deep as possible.
Ground ball.
Real simple. We are driving our head to the bag, touching the front part of the base, breaking down past it, going through, breaking down, getting wide, looking right, looking left. Kind of like a UPS guy. Thank you, Coach Sheets.
Okay, moving on. You know, moving on to round the horn here. Leads and rules of first base. The biggest thing we talk about barometer to do that. So the first thing we do to get connected with me and the base runner is to show me the outs so we all know what's going on. And then we establish, when do we start to take a lead? And if we really don't nail this down to having a lead, to when to take the lead, it's going to be hard for us to really get in the flow of what we're trying to do. So our key for this is start when the pitcher toes. Whenever that pitcher toes, that's when we're going to take our lead. And our lead, as far as the technique, is basically a two-stride shuffle getting to 12-foot. It's basically what we're looking at there is a step and a dive back. We're always trying to get back to the back part of the bag. That's one of the ways we get back to the base. The other way is just get big and, you know, show our back to the pitcher. Hopefully we get a deflection on that. So it's a 12-foot lead, and those are some of the things that we look for. To get connected with our base runner, I think it's a really different situation. What we try to do is we do a lot of hand signs. I want our guys to be able to slow things down. I don't want to be yelling over people. I mean, a lot of times it's loud. You might have a team that chirps. You never know what the situation is. So I want our hitter to be calm. I don't want to be yelling across the field to different people. And so, you know, what we try to do is get into our hand signs. And our hand signs, a lot of these are really simple things. But the first thing we always try to go over is back online. Pretty simple. Self-explanatory. So we go over that. I make sure our guys understand that. So back online we also talk about see the ball down, see the ball down. Okay, so we also have right here where we see, hey, ball kicks, it's big, we're going to go. We have ball where it's little and kicks. So we're doing all kinds of different things so these guys understand. We have right here, we're not running a slide step. But the most important thing that it says here on the keyboard here is front foot. Front foot is so important because we're trying to establish when can we advance with ball in the dirt. And so for us to do this, to stay on time with the ball in the dirt, we want to actually start our shuffle when the pitcher starts to touch the ground. Okay, that's an established. And why we do that is for our guys to get in sequence so we can re-ball in the dirt. So one of the biggest things that I learned growing up, going through the JUCO ranks myself, was a little riddle that kind of helped me stay in line here was, ball to the right, stay tight. Ball to the left, it's a theft. Meaning ball to the right, it's a lot easier for the catcher to pick it up, obviously being right-handed, and to try to throw you out. Ball to the left is a theft. It's a little bit harder to get around to try to throw you out. So we are dominating that area, and that's, you know, something that we look forward to when we're talking about rules and leads, and those are just simple standards that we try to accomplish. So we also have, you know, a video that we can talk about here.
A simple technique on our first base lead. Always want to make sure that the first thing we're doing is making sure we have connection with the third base coach. So we are identifying the outs too, okay? Next thing we're going to do, gentlemen, is take our lead, okay? We cannot do anything until we get on time. How we get on time, gentlemen, is when the pitcher tells us. That's when we start our lead. The pitcher has to tell us. Otherwise, we are just flailing around for no reason at all. Simple technique for our leads at first base. Could be a one and a two and a half shuffle with our head up. As the pitcher comes set, we're going to go ahead and cheat and slide one more over to get to 12 feet. And it's got to work in sequence.
All right, guys, moving around the horn here, leads and rules at second base is something that really is a separator in all areas for us. And we're still establishing hand signs when we're doing this, still staying connected with our base runner at this point in time. But our technique at second base, moving into a lead, is seven steps, which we equal 21 feet. The biggest thing that we try to do there after we get our lead is mark where we're at. I think this helps us. Any foul ball that's hit, we don't have to remark it every time. So we know where we're at in every play, if it's a pickoff, whatever the case may be. So that's the first things first. The other thing that we try to do to gain some ground is when the pitcher looks into the catcher for signs, we slide over from left to right to get to 24 to get as much as we possibly can. So that's something we try to do to cheat it any way we possibly can to gain some ground. This enables us to get right to what we try to do in our base running system. You know, we really like to use the vault system, which we can talk about later on in the Q&A. Any kind of situation we do, but it puts us in a really good situation. So nobody out. This is where the rules start, that we have to be really cognitive and understanding that, hey, we have to know the rules. We test these weekly. We go over these things. But bottom line is you have to validate it by practicing it. So with nobody out, reading height and depth, this trumps everything. So with no outs, back to tag. Height and depth equals tag. No height and depth, that's when you got to be a smart base runner. That's when you got to learn how to read. So if we know where the outfielders are playing, we'll have a better idea of what we're doing. We just have to be really aware. It's, again, being connected with our coaches. So leads and rolls at second base, one out. Obviously, this is less rules, more reads, and this one you got to be a little bit more instinctive on things. One out, we're reading height and depth, trumps everything, and I can say this, I can't say this too much, because bottom line is, this what means everything for us. So hang at the halfway mark with one out will help us, make better reads, make more decision-making that has a chance for us to either score or get to third base. So two outs, that's self-explanatory. That's create an angle with the lead.
Base lead technique. It's a seven-step lead. One, two, three, four, five, six, and a seven should bring us here. So what we want to do is simply mark it so we know where we're at all times of the play. If we have a foul ball, we don't have to run all the way back. We just come back to the mark. We always know where we're supposed to be. So this is 21 feet right here, all right? So we can establish a little bit of cheat method here. If the pitcher starts to look for some signs from the catcher, we can simply slide from left to right, which gets us to 24 feet.
This gets us to our spot where we can steal, we can work ball in the dirt, okay? We can work every technique that we work on with our system.
So this is pretty much self-explanatory stuff that we work on. But again, these are things that we test every week and making sure our guys understand how important this is. Simple things, and it's very elementary. But again, we try to pride ourselves on doing the little things right. And this is totally separate from how we steal bases. But understanding the game, we want our guys to be educated. We want them to be smart. We want them to ask us questions. So the slow roll to third baseman is one way. Ground ball is past the pitcher. And left of the shortstop, shortstop and third baseman cross. Shortstop comes in on slow rollers. Ground ball to shortstop in the sixth hole, go on release. And that's key to all the ground balls in advancing second base. So leads and rules at third base. And this is obviously overlooked as well, because I think you have to have something in place here to be successful. You know, we are always trying to inch to steal runs somehow. So one of the things that we try to do is always have our head up, obviously. Watch throws back to the pitcher. Because anytime you can watch that throw back to the pitcher and you're anticipating some, you're going to create some pressure on the catcher. More importantly, I really like to make the infielders back up. And so we're going to work hard to make our infielders that are actually opposing infielders back up, so they're actually using more energy. So technique-wise, primary lead equals a three-step in foul territory. We want to be in foul territory, but we want to get as tight as possible to the line. Obviously, it's the shortest distance. It's a straight line to home plate. So secondary lead equals a walk lead of 21 feet. And the biggest thing that we talk about here is the right foot down, anticipating wild pitch on contact. So we also have verbals and hand signs that we obviously like to go over too. We have a down call. We simply just say down. So a lot of times this will happen with a guy at second and at third base, so I know what's on the same page, so I don't have to verbalize it to key things to other teams. We have hand signs as well. As far as seeing it through, so we're just saying see it through as a hand sign. If we say a down call, it might be a down call where, hey, we're gambling right there, so we have to see downward angle. But we do have different things that we do. We have a short video to talk about it real quick.
All right, gentlemen, some of the things that we try to do to be really sharp at third base, which is always overlooked. First, we try to get tight with the line, okay? We don't want to have any wasted movements over in foul territory. The shortest distance is obviously to home plate is being on a straight line. So that's number one. Number two is we're always watching the baseball. On the throwback from the catcher back to the pitcher, we will steal a couple runs if our head's on the baseball at all times. As a third base coach, I'm always coaching our guys. If there's a guy at third base, where he's at. But most importantly, your job is to watch the baseball and be on time. Technique is simple. Three steps. One, two, three. Get squared up with the pitcher. Get on time with the pitcher. After he established that he's throwing to the plate, it's simple. It's going to right, left, right, down on contact. That pitcher delivers the baseball and it's through the zone. Then we're simply reading and reacting. But we have to be on time. The key is, gentlemen, is if we're not too early, where we get stuck in the mud, or if we're not too late, where we can't make a decision.
These are our base running absolutes. And again, this is something that we use during, you know, during classroom time is what we'd say. And so we test and make sure we know all these. I'm just going to pick on a couple of these. Obviously, the most important thing, if we really want to be successful as a base runner, is we always have to have our head up. Know where the ball is. Only time you should put your head down is when you're driving your eyes to first base or touching the base. So that's so important for us to understand is you can't be a good base runner if your head's not up. So that's the first thing that we have to talk about with a lot of our base runners is they're not used to that. So we work on that on a daily basis. Number five is the hit and run. Peek on first step. We used to be, as far as for me personally, I used to always go into the third step peek. And so until one of our guys got hit in the back, and that there goes that. So I think first step peek helped us a little bit better in that we can give us a little bit more time to evaluate where the play is. We can make a better read from first to third or what have you. So these are just base running absolutes that I think we should know and everybody should know, that hopefully it's a takeaway for you guys. Moving on to the next thing. This is kind of our core four, what we call here. And this is a practice plan that we work on every single day. There's so many different variations that we can use from this. What we're trying to do in this situation is trying to create a really game-like, competitive, you know, situation here where we bring in four pitchers. We can bring in two lefties, two righties, whatever the case may be. What we try to do in the first circuit is at home plate, we're working on hard rounds. First base, front foot, ball in the dirt. Second base, nobody out. Back to tag, third base. We love the safety squeeze play that we try to work on. So, and that is just one variation. You know, we can also work, hey, just at first base, we can work on a right-handed pitcher as far as timing. Just like everybody else, you know, a lot of teams do these days. They have momentum leads that we call them. So we work on our short leads, we work on our extended leads, everything that you can imagine. At second base, we work on our vaults. Really good technique with our vaults. We can also, you know, work the other side of the field. Two second basemen and two first base plays. So there's so many variations that we can work from this. And we spend about 15 to 20 minutes every single day working on these things to help us grow. And we can put situations in where it's bunts, wash them down, put a machine out there. So this is so creative in what you can do. And it's really helped us through the years. We'll videotape it, watching our guys to see who's doing some things correctly, who's on time, go back the next day, make some adjustments, because you can get a lot of reps in a short amount of time. So that's something I really appreciate about this. So those are some things that are some takeaways, and I really appreciate you guys listening. The last thing I kind of want to get into is just some simple hand signs that we go over on, you know, a daily basis. And again, I can't overemphasize this much, but you know, hand signs back online, keep us out of double play. Seeing the ball down is so important. Seeing it kick. And we use these, like I said, again, to get connected with all of our base runners. So I think it's very important to understand slide step. We don't run on slide step. And there's probably five or six more that we get into. But I think it's important for a young coach in a program to have something in place that you can use instead of, you know, verbalizing and yelling and screaming, whatever the case may be. But I appreciate it. I wish I could talk about more. There's so many things to get into with base running, but you know, this is the nuts and bolts of what we try to do on a daily basis. Thank you, Coach Bart.
Coach Fournier, I appreciate you, man. It's great. Thanks for taking the time today to knock that out. And, you know, obviously, if anyone's not familiar with Wabash Valley College, just Google it. Go to the program's website. I mean, just dozens of drafts and hundreds of guys moving on to college and players from all over the country and all over the world that have thrived in that environment, as not only making them better players, but better people. Been doing it the right way for a long, long time. And thank you very much for joining us today.
Appreciate you.
All right. We're going to cruise along into our last presenter of the day. We're only running a few minutes behind schedule, thank goodness. But I want to welcome Link Jarrett to us. Link is the head coach at the University of Notre Dame. A lot of you are familiar with who the University of Notre Dame is. Link has spoken at the ABCA National Convention. And he was the head coach at UNC Greensboro on hitting. But he's going to come to us today with infield play. So, Link, let me know when you want me to fire that PowerPoint up, my man.
Well, you can go ahead and crank it up. And now I know, Rob, now I know why Spitznagel was such a good base runner. So that was good stuff. I learned a lot. And, Bart, thanks for having me. You can go ahead and put the PowerPoint up, and we can roll right through it.
I'm trying to do that. I usually share from my browser, so this might take me a second, to be honest with you. So if you want to ad lib a little bit, give a little bit about your background, I would appreciate that.
I gave this talk a couple months ago, and Scott Wingo, our volunteer, helped me, and he's a phenomenal baseball guy, two-time national champion, MVP of the College World Series. So he works with our outfielders and infielders, and is just a remarkable winning addition to our program and what we're building at Notre Dame. So, you know, I want to thank Wingo for his input when we did this last time, and I'm going to roll with it again. I thought it was helpful. When I listen to presentations or when I give presentations, I really like to walk away with something I feel like I can implement immediately in my own workouts. And that is exactly what I hope this becomes for anybody that's listening. I think the more we listen and the more we can process, the better off we're going to be if we just take bits and pieces. So hopefully there's some bits and pieces in here. You can go ahead to the next one. The first thing I think any organization needs to develop a very simple but consistent practical warm-up program so the players really are able to do this on their own. This is before any sort of activity. You know, obviously a team practice, a game, you know, we have to do group work, skill work. So I really like to use what we call a dynamic warm-up for every aspect of their preparation. And, you know, fortunately at Notre Dame, we have great strength staff and training staff. So I always get their input on how we should facilitate this warm-up. But then the guys actually run. I don't want a coach to have to monitor this. The older players know how important it is. And when you're in small groups, you know, there might be a group of outfielders that are doing their skill session. The infielders need to be able to really run this on their own to get loose so that we can jump right into their skill training. I really don't want that dynamic warm-up to move beyond 10 minutes. You know, there's a little stretching at the end of the – it's really short 25-yard bursts of running and jogging and some exercises, and there's some static stretching at the end. But I don't want it to go beyond 10 minutes. Then we move into our throwing program. We actually use cones, and Wingo ran this for us. And as we get closer to the season, you know, we can lengthen that out a little bit. But initially, it might be 7-8 minutes of throwing from certain distances, and then it might progress into a 10-minute throwing cycle, backing all the way up to 180 feet. Knowing that we're going to do a significant amount of throwing once we get into our actual practice. As we work back in, we always go to about 45 feet and we have our stopwatch and we do what I call as a quick feet, quick hands drill. All the position players do it. The pitchers at this point would be doing their own drill work and throwing, so they're not incorporating the quick feet aspect here. But it's just keeping both hands together and really moving your feet and trying to catch the ball in the middle of your body with a very clean exchange. And really, highly skilled outfielders should be able to do this just as well as the infielders. They're dealing with a bigger glove, but it's just footwork and concentration and a clean exchange. You can go to the next one. And we go into our individual drills. So I usually take the infield group, and we may have 7, 8, 9 infielders. They all bring a ball to me. They face me, and, you know, they start about 4 or 5 yards away, and they throw me a ball, and off they go. They drop step, and it really doesn't matter to me which side they open with first. You know, you'd like them to open with their throwing hand side, ideally if the ball's straight back over their head. But I'm going to work over both shoulders, and I think the most important thing is that they make an aggressive, legitimate drop step and turn and run in a straight line immediately behind them. And I usually line up with some piece of whether it's the wall, the scoreboard, a light pole, so that I always have a reference point for them to quickly show them what their drop step angle looked like. And then I just throw, after they've taken 4 or 5 steps, I throw a low line drive or a, you know, a little flare pop up, and I want them to run. I'll throw one over each shoulder, and then I'll throw, you know, a couple right over their head, some of them where they have to make a full head turn adjustment, and some where they just maybe angle just slightly and don't have to make a full head turn. All of these plays are done with one hand. You know, this little drill is another dimension of making sure these guys are warmed up and ready to really sprint and run. And it's fun to have some pushing the envelope with these guys. You'll have some that are more athletic and can really run balls down at a greater distance. And you have maybe some of your first basemen that this is a little bit more of a challenge, but you have to have some touch and feel when you're throwing the ball. But that should take really no more than 2 minutes. Then we go into some spot in the infield. Our field is turf. At Notre Dame, if you have a natural surface, I would try to avoid doing your ground ball drills right in like your shortstop spot or your second base spot. I just try to move around a little bit, and sometimes I do it right behind the second base bag, sometimes in the 4-hole or the 6-hole. but I just take a bucket, you know, I've got a dozen balls in there. And I'm about probably 9 big paces, 24 to 27 feet, maybe a little further. They bounce into their ready position. And when you get to about 27 feet, it seems like it's right. And I'm just rolling 5 or 6 balls right at the guys. And in the first few, I want them to just break down, you know, right, left, square up to the ball, try to center it up. I want to see, you can go back one. Yep, there you go. I want them to center that thing up on their body. And then I want it to be a very quick right, left, and deliver a nice throw right back to my chest. And they can put a little something on it. That footwork, to me, when you're throwing it right back in front of you, really requires the most efficiency with how you move your feet and the direction there, as opposed to, for example, a second baseman who would field it and really shuffle more to his left. So I change the speed of those balls, but it kind of gets them into just a more of an infield mindset and starting to break down and widen the legs and flatten that back out and let me see that glove position where the fingertips of the glove are hanging straight down. Then I'll do a couple at their position, and the third baseman know that their double play type feed footwork is really different, obviously, than a second baseman. But they're not throwing that ball back to me until they have completed an aggressive footwork look from the ball that I rolled them to make their feed. The shortstop, some of them may turn into an aggressive flip look, and then they throw the ball back to me. The second baseman, some of them might be the little jump turn where they really need to get off their feet a little bit, jump turn where their toes are pointed at the shortstop and they kind of work like they're going to throw it there. Then they pop it back to me. But they're really – all of these balls essentially end up coming back to me where I roll it. Okay, you can go to the next one. Then I do forehand, backhand. I try to do this every day, and these are one-hand touch type drills. It doesn't matter how good a fungo hitter you are. It's hard to really, from a full distance, get them to have to field every ball with one hand, and I want them to expand their range. And they're maybe a little bit closer than when I roll it straight on. I think 18 to 21 feet is probably accurate. I wouldn't want to be any closer than that. I'm rolling the ball hard, and all I want them to do is take 2-3 hard steps to their forehand side. I mean, this is simulating a rocket hard ground ball that they're going to have to fully extend for. I don't want them diving for these balls, but I want them low. I want them to expand their range. That crossover is so important. Early glove extension and opening that glove and reaching early on a ball hit this hard, critical. And on a forehand, you actually might catch the ball deeper behind your actual glove side of your body because you're extending and because you've crossed over properly and maybe even deepened your angle a little bit. And I really like them to overutilize their spin to finish the throw on these forehands. It's a very important play at any position. So if that momentum takes you at all deeper than the line that would really carry you to first base, I want them to spin. And then they can fire that ball back to me, and I want them to have some fun. They might throw it back at a little lower arm slot, but I want them to challenge me and whip it back to me once they finish the play and made a spin like they're really going to throw the ball to first base. Then they throw it back to me. You can go to the next one. Then we go to our backhand extension. It's really the same thing, and the guys might have gotten 3 or 4 forehands. And to be honest, if I feel like the team needs more work on their left, I may do 6 or 7 of that on any given day. Maybe there was something that happened in a game or practice that I feel like I need to hammer a point. Once I've done that, backhand, same distance. Obviously, the difference when you backhand is the glove has to carry itself all the way across your body. So it's a harder glove transition, and you have to be a little earlier on a hard backhand low type ground ball. You're also going to catch some of these a little bit further in front of your body simply because your glove is now on the front part of your body. So you're not going to catch that as deep. Like you may catch the forehand occasionally well behind you. I don't think that happens as often with a backhand. And there's really two things that you have to work on when you feel the backhand. You know, sometimes you might come down and your glove foot might be planted and you might actually backhand the ball off your glove foot. To make a strong throw, you're going to have to get to your right foot and then redirect your left foot and get that foot pointed back at your target. And that changes if you're playing third, short, or second, really. So redirecting the left foot as I'm watching them field and get ready to throw the ball back, like where the first baseman would be for them, that's what I'm watching. Is the glove open early? Are they carrying it low? How did they catch it? And then what do they end up doing to redirect the foot that's going to take them to their target? Then they throw it back to me. You know, you might catch it on your throwing foot side, and there's times when you catch the backhand off your throwing foot, you might just kind of settle and ride down in there and not take a full shuffle. There are times if you can cut across a little bit and bite off some depth on the ground ball, you might have time to shuffle to make the throw across the infield. So I'll give them some rolls. You know, again, you're rolling the ball from 20, 21 feet. You ought to be able to manage the speed and get a couple different things accomplished just by rolling the ball to them. And then the jump throw, a true, real extension. Jeter, I think this is probably one of the things he was known for, was his ability to backhand and jump and turn and throw it. And this is an important play. I want them to have some fun with it. They're going to throw that ball right back to me. There's no simulation of throwing it across to a first baseman. They're throwing it right back to me. I don't roll that ball quite as hard, but I make them maybe run a little further, and the pace and the feel kind of indicates to them that I might have to jump, turn, and throw that. And then at the end of the backhands, I'll actually kind of throw some balls down. Like the other ones have basically been rolled. I'm on my feet, but it's a rolled ball. I might actually kind of sidearm throw some chopped type balls so that they start to sense, all right, that ball bounced up. It's not hit hard. I have to come around the corner and get it. And it might turn into a one-handed play, like coming around to get it as opposed to a ball that I need to backhand. So I mix that in at the end. And just based on how they catch it, do I need to set my feet? Do I have time? I would like you to set your feet to drive the ball across the infield if you can. Just because you fielded it on the run doesn't mean you have to throw it on the run. But if it's slow enough and you've had to eat up enough ground along the way, you might have to throw it on the run. So, again, those balls to your right, whether it's a backhand or something you try to get around, I think those are important as you try to develop your infielders and build a good practice for them. Okay, you can go to the next one. All right, I started this one probably 5 or 6 years ago because I couldn't find a mechanism other than balls off the bat to get the infielders to understand what that drop step is, to really open up and try to catch the ball that's taken kind of an in-between but long hop. This is not a ball that you should have to knock down, but I get about 12 to 15 feet away. I think that's the distance where that little line drive, and it could be a two-hopper, but I think that one that bounces about that far away and is going to come up waist high or maybe a little bit higher, if it's hit hard, you can open up and literally run with it. And it almost has the look when it's to your glove side like the pop-up drill we started with. I'm going to open, drop step, and I'm going to turn and run. Now, you may only get a step or two if it's really a ball that's hit hard, but being able to manage that can really make a tough play and an awkward hop become a nice long hop, and it's pretty easy to catch. And it should be easy to throw because it's hit hard and you've got time. I try to get them to spin. If it takes them glove side a lot, I try to get them to spin, and then they can throw the ball back across kind of like where the first baseman would be. And then they just shoot it back to me. But if you watched us do that at practice, I think initially if you walked out and that's what you saw us doing, it might be something that made you ask, what is this drill about? But I explained it to the guys, and I really do think it has helped. If you don't give them this three-minute segment, they may go a whole practice and really not get a true kind of in-between open-up type line drive. And then I do the same thing to the right. They turn and run. Turn and go, open up, run as hard as you can, go with it, and just catch it and work to throw back across the diamond. Okay, let's flip it. This is something I've enjoyed more and more. I really look at – it's just called a grid because as I construct it, that's obviously the look that it has. everybody's going to do their two-man fungo, their four-man type ground ball fungo. I think that is important. This would be something that I would do. This grid would be maybe something that I wanted to do for a skill session, maybe an 18-minute, 15-minute type session. And you can make each one of these. I just go 5-4-3-6-3-3-6-1. So I'm reading left to right there across the first line. And however long I've designated for that segment, you know, you could do this for 2 minutes, 4 minutes. It really, really doesn't matter. Before we would do that, I'd probably bang them a few fungos just to kind of get them ready. But then the way I do this, it divides the field up really into three areas, and it allows the guys to recover a little bit. If you have one at a position or two at a position, it's still manageable. But this would be a 5-4-3 double play. It would be a shortstop throwing the ball to first base, but he's going to work towards the middle. And then the first baseman would bounce right off the bag, and he would throw it to the shortstop who already had worked in the middle. And then you throw it back over, and you might have two first basemen. Somebody could take a throw, or you might have just an extra body over there to take the throw to give your first baseman a breather. Then I'd go right back 5-4-3, 6-3 up the middle, 3-6-1. And I would just rapid fire that until I got to the end of my time. And I think it's very game applicable. The guy in the shortstop position that's working to the middle, we always try to communicate ball, 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 to clear that second baseman out of the way. And then the 3-6-1, your shortstop, you'd want him on the inside of second base to take the throw from the first baseman. And when I say hold, that means he's holding the runner. He's not deep. And then the next one would be a 5-3, so your third baseman throwing the ball just across the diamond to first base, a 6-4-3 double play, and then a 3-6 with the first baseman deep. And I just put that loaded, like the bases are loaded. Obviously, he would be back in that situation for us most of the time, and that's how we would handle round two. Again, you could just look at what I did these first two. Second base pivots at the bag are something that takes a ton of reps. So each one of those rows gives me an opportunity to not only work with the guy that's fielding the ball, but I'm also watching. If I'm hitting this myself, I'm going to get a lot of opportunities to coach the double play pivot in a live ground ball type setting, which I think is very, very important. The timing of it. You know, how quickly you get to the bag, which side of the base do you try to pivot from, all that's important. Then a 6-3, a 5-3, and a 4-6-3 with a feed and pivot. And if you divide your field up, it's really limitless how many different creative things you can come up with while you give the infielders a chance to catch their breath in between their rep. Go ahead to the next one. At the end of this, I would do some slow rollers. And this might just be a two-minute segment. Believe it or not, you know, those guys, this gets them a little bit from a cardio standpoint, but 4.2 seconds or less. I change the speed of the ground ball. A slow roller for your shortstop may not really be a ball that your second baseman has to really run through and field with one hand. So is it a slow roller? That's an important teaching mechanism there. If you have a stopwatch and somebody can time it for you, great. We try to shoot for 4.2 seconds or less. And as we go through it, we coach the understanding that if you're doing this in 3.5 seconds, you know, there might have been something in there that allowed you to slow yourself down a little bit, take your time, and not make the play quite so quickly. So there's that happy medium. Obviously, to record an out, we try to go under 4.2. Third baseman, shortstop, the ball's glove side. We try to use two hands to make the slow roller play. If it's to your right, we try to get around it a little bit like we did in our initial drill. Catch it with one hand, and then you have to decide, do I set my feet or throw on the run? Then we'd move to back to the four hole there, second baseman, first baseman, communicate. 4 or 3-1, you need to have somebody else if you only have one first baseman standing at that base. But we need to have a ball call really more from the second baseman. I'm fine with the second baseman throwing it to a pitcher, but ideally if it's a ball you can comfortably get, you'd much rather have that first baseman sprint back to the base and take the throw to make the play most efficiently. And then we always end our segments with the first baseman at the bag, low throws, high throws, knee high, and I'm throwing these from probably 35, 40 feet, short hops, balls they have to try to stay on the bag and reach for. I think these are very important for your first baseman. They're going to touch the ball as much as your pitcher and catcher, so they better be good around the bag. We're almost done. Next one. This is incorporating the pitchers. So the first one, for example, it looks like there'd be two pitchers, a 3-1 and a 1-6-3 and a 5-4-3. So I'm just going right across the row with that grid. There would be two pitchers that run out to the mound on this one. The next one would be a 4 or 3-1. So it was the little drill that they did in the previous back end of that grid, 4 or 3-1. That pitcher's learning to really get over there, a 1-2-3 comebacker. And then first and second bunt defense, you can put on whatever bunt defense you want, but the more the third baseman and the pitcher can read that play and handle it properly, the better off you're going to be. So, again, we'd go through that row. And then a pick at first, a pick at second with the second baseman, and then a 5 or 6-3, so kind of a tweener ball in the six hole that the third baseman and shortstop would have to communicate on and actually make the throw across. So, again, each one of these things gives one segment of the infield some work where the other group is down for a second to catch their breath, because you're going to spend some time and it's going to be a taxing drill by the time it's over. At the end, this has been a fun one. We'll run four pitchers to the mound, and they'll actually take the throw at first base from each double play. So you'll do a 5-4-3, and there's a pitcher on the mound. So when that fun goes hit, he's really got to bust it over there. But I think it helps the infielders understand, like, if they've turned that double play and the pitcher's nowhere near it, we probably had time on the front end of the play to slow things down a little bit, have a better tempo, because that guy's going to be there. The pitcher will be there. It just highlights each facet of that play. And then the pitcher, to handle all of these throws at the first base bag, you know, it improves their athleticism. And this is rapid fire. So 5-4-3, as soon as that third baseman has thrown it and I see the pivot has been made, I'm hitting the ground ball to short. So there's not a lot of time. This is a rapid fire drill, 4-6-3 and then 3-6-1. At the end of this, man, these guys they're gassed. Each pitcher has had multiple reps. And again, it gives the infielders a chance to regroup in between. So again, you can do whatever you want in the grid. You can do far more PFP than this one shows, but those two are good examples. And then the last one, I always use this slide. I like it. It's just through the years of what I think it takes to do it right. And every time we go out there, like, to earn that title of coach, are we keeping things in order for the players? Like, are we taking care of the field? Are we keeping the facility in check? Are the cage nets and the things that they use every day, even on their own, is this stuff up to par and safe? And it shows that you care about them, and every little detail of this is important. And Rob talked about this: study and communicate and chart and do tests. And, you know, you provide another mechanism other than just your verbal cues and what's going on when you chart stuff and when you video it and when you keep score of what's going on. We do it with our drills. We do it with our offensive stuff. So I think the instruction and the motivation, and then, you know, stories and at the right time inspiring these athletes to keep pushing it, is all part of earning that coach title. So I rolled through that pretty quickly. I probably went about 25 minutes, but hopefully that was helpful.
Sorry, Coach Jarrett, had to get out of my screen share and get back in. And
no, thanks for doing that.
All that good stuff. So, yeah, absolutely. Really, really good stuff. I love, you call it the grids. We did it my previous life as a head coach. I was a catcher my whole life. I was not an infield guy. If you've seen my body type, you know I wasn't playing infield except for first base. But I love that same thing, man. You do a 5-3-6-4, and you just go around the horn. And then we would always end with what we called gold, and that was our runner on third, end of game, can't score, infield in, essentially.
Yeah.
And it's like you kind of build to a crescendo. You're going to the 5-3s and the 6-4s, and guys are going. Then you start turning double plays. The energy goes up a little bit. And then you end that sucker with an infield in, like, don't let anybody score, and you are smoking balls at guys left, right, up, down. You know, it's a competition thing. We always like that.
That's awesome, man. And I agree 100%. At some point, you know, your drill work and your technique and trying to find – I mean, we could do a fielding position seminar that could last 2 days on how to break down and how do you use your feet and what footwork on this ball. But at some point, like you're saying, you have to go out there and make plays with the technique that you have at that moment and perform. And I think that is important. So that's kind of a mesh of some technical stuff that we do drill-wise and then also some reality of you have to be able to turn the big double play. And like you said at the end, you have to make the game-winning type play when it counts.
Absolutely. Great stuff, Coach Jarrett. Well, we still got some room for some questions in the Q&A, even though it's going to be a little truncated session here. We'll go with Coach Carroll. First off, how do you manage Rafael Figueroa? How do you manage the studies of the players with a plan of this type? I know it's a little different for you, you know, academy setting, and I'm assuming you're talking about the players that you have that are in school, you know, as the feeders to your national team. So how do you manage that? Is there a certain anything special in place there in Great Britain that you guys do?
It's a great question, and I think you probably get some better answers from high school and college coaches, including coaches Fournier and Jarrett. For us, full transparency, we don't see players more than three times a week, and I think with that kind of commitment at the national team's level, it's non-negotiable that you should be able to manage school and baseball when we only practice three times a week. I would say the most effective tool we've incorporated is a 1-6-8 plan, where the players have to own that. They are going to plan out their full week, every hour of their week. And we've had some success there where they figure out how they manage their school and baseball commitments. And just like we talked about, we want to be our own best coach. We need to be our own best planner as well. So I recommend the 1-6-8 plan.
Awesome. Very good. Coach Fournier, can you elaborate a little bit more about the you touched on it, and then so we get to the Q&A, the vault system?
Well, it's just something that you know, we started some time ago that obviously I probably picked it up when, you know, obviously some other good baseball coaches and whatnot, but it's something we use to steal bases, obviously, but it's something that we do also to keep our head up, to square up on balls in the dirt. I think it's a great system for us to just keep our eyes on the baseball and know what's going on in front of you, and it keeps us in balance, it keeps us on line with things. We've used it for a while, and I think it's important that, you know, everybody does things different ways, but I think for us, we use it for stealing, you know, third base, obviously, but I think it's important because it keeps you square, and it keeps you back online, and all the little things that we do, I think, you know, it's something that we practice from the first day that we get to school.
That's right. So vault's more of a verbal cue that you use with the guys to help them have a little bit better understanding, right?
Yeah, so basically, you know, it's me and the base runner. You know, his job is obviously to see the baseball. My job is to watch the infielders, okay? And so it's a safe way to go. But at the same time, it's an aggressive way, but it's all built on trust. You have to have trust when you do the vault system. And I could do a segment, and we all could do a segment, people that do use the vault, and it could take 20 minutes just to go over it. But you have to practice it. The technique has to be first. And then you got to apply the game, and you cannot be fearful. You cannot be scared to get thrown out, you know, because there's just so many things to it. But bottom line is I love it because it keeps us square and it keeps us in line with every possible play that you have to advance third base.
Perfect. Coach Jarrett, Rich Moretta would like to know, most of the discussion as it relates to infield play is always centered on, you know, the middle and third base. So what drills do you recommend specifically for first basemen? And do you incorporate stretching as part of that?
I think the bag work is the most important piece for a first baseman. I think most of the problems occur in an inability to handle a low throw that should be caught, not knowing when to come off the bag, jumping for a ball that you really don't need to come off the bag and jump for, that you could just reach for and catch. Most of our work is done around the base. I think the ball in the four hole is also important. I can't remember the White Sox, the pitcher that would have thrown the perfect game. It's probably been 5-6 years now, but the first baseman ran all the way over in front of the second baseman and backhanded the ball and threw it, and they called him safe and whatever. I think trying to read the ball that's in the four hole so that you know I can turn and go back and take the throw. So what happened to the White Sox doesn't happen where your guys are trying to make long throws to the pitcher. In that case, the first baseman never should have thrown the ball to the pitcher. The second baseman should have just called that ball and picked it up and thrown it to the first baseman. So those are the two things from a first base perspective that I think are most important is simply touches around the bag and an ability to manage that and catch the tough throw or keep the really bad throw in front of you and not let it rattle around and get into the dugout or get over where base runners are going to take multiple bases. So that's what we do the most with our first baseman, the four hole and then simply the balls, you know, around the bag.
Excellent. Coach Carroll, Varun would like to know, does Team Great Britain give access to coaches from other sports to come and learn some aspects of baseball which can translate to other sports, say, like cricket?
So, absolutely. We've not had a ton of coaches from other sports, but 100% welcome to that idea. We'd love to learn from other sports, and specifically in terms of cricket, there's a number of our coaches who have worked with cricket players. There's a lot of transfer. We're entirely encouraging if cricket players want to come and try baseball and vice versa. And ultimately, just like we're thieves and sponges within our community, we want to learn from other sports too. And just look us up on Twitter or Facebook and get involved.
Excellent. And speaking of, I'll give you a little cricket segue. Coach Fournier and I had the pleasure of coaching someone who's wasn't Brent's dad, the national team coach or something like that, or he's the Australian national team baseball coach after being a professional cricket player. So we're very familiar with the sport. The Aussies would be at the dorms and bring their cricket sticks out and be hitting the ball around out there. So we're very familiar. Coach Fournier, Kalnoa Hong, and forgive me if I mispronounce the name. Says, I see the leads at second base at 21 feet, and third base, you mentioned 21 feet after the secondary. So at first base, would you like to see 21 feet after the secondary? And what distance do you suggest as a runner's first base primary lead? I think you talked 12 feet for the primary lead. I know it depends on player size and agility, but is there a marker that you use for to where they should be at after their secondary?
Yeah, I mean, it's right at 22 feet is what we're looking at after our shuffles. It's not a perfect science, but it is more, I think, the more important thing to worry about is being on time when the ball crosses the plate or if it's a dirt ball situation. But after our two shuffles, that's what we should be getting to, right around 21, 22 feet, yes.
Okay. Friend of the program, Matthew Chandler, with a question for Coach Link Jarrett. When developing 13- and 14-year-olds, what areas of infield play would you place a premium focus on?
Trying to pick out the right hop, so lively, good feet, and then glove position where the fingers of the glove are, I don't know if you guys can see it, like this way. I think a lot of young infielders put the glove down where the back of the glove is flat. It's really trying to get that glove where the fingertips are hanging down. I think that turns into a real tool. And then throwing accuracy. Everybody is so caught up in the radar gun and the velocity and the showcases where how fast am I throwing the ball across the infield? I mean, that eventually is important, but it's not as important as the accuracy and the command of what you're doing when you throw the ball across the field. So feet moving, bouncing, trying to find a good hop, a really nice glove position. You know, obviously I think, you know, if you study it at all, you can figure out that feet need to be more than shoulder width and you try to flatten the back out. But it seems to me like the young infielder, the sooner they can learn to just let that glove hang down almost right underneath their chin where the back of the glove is not on the ground, that gives them the best chance to actually catch the ball. Then they transition into the throw and they're trying to drive that ball through the first baseman's belt buckle. It's not how hard, it's how accurately I can use my feet and drive that ball and finish it. We try to throw every throw through the belt buckle. And that, even if it is at the belt buckle, your first baseman usually is in a position where he still catches that ball and makes it look like it was more chest high because he's athletic and he works his way down through it. And that's really the throw we want. So feet, glove position, and using your legs to drive and finish the throw accurately.
Through the belt buckle, that's a really good verbal that I haven't heard before. So that's really good. That's a really good reference point.
For our picks, for really any throw, I think that's the target. You know, the infield, like you talked about, the play at the plate, if you had to make a throw infield in, belt buckle high is really, for me, the best throw. It's the best to catch, the best to tag. You know, and it's the best really to handle at any base in any situation, as opposed to trying to throw it down where somebody might tag it or throw it, you know, chest high to the first baseman. I think belt buckle is a good medium.
Very good. Liam, CJ, Jaya Sakara would like to know, regarding the LTAD practice design, age groups, et cetera, how do you decide what percentage for hours are divided between practice and games per week, per cycle, is it annual, et cetera?
Good. Another great question, and it's complex here. We have our players in so many environments. We have them for some amount of the time. They also are in the club environment, and we certainly hope the younger they are that they're in other sports. And to some extent, if they're in other sports, that looks after some of the athletic needs. We don't have to focus on them. For example, if they're playing a basketball, that's going to tick some boxes for us. So it's complicated. Ultimately, we'll just follow the model, and the USA model is a great one to look at for balancing how much a kid should be playing versus training and how that evolves the older they get. So I just point anyone to the USA Baseball resource.
As you should, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you. If you're not familiar with the USA Baseball LTAD, it's the USA Baseball's long-term athlete development plan. There's some really easy to follow. There's a easily digestible version that is graphics heavy and got some really good scientific backed information. If you are an academic type person, there's the full length report that you can read from medical professionals with a lot more letters after their name than I have. I choose to go into the easily digestible version that's graphics heavy that gets me the pertinent information, which is good. Coach Fournier, one last question for you real quick. What's an easily adaptable way for coaches and players to begin to pick up on ability to steal second base? I know for a while you used the UCLA method on doing counts for pitchers. Is that still something that you all use? Are there any other targets that you have when it comes to reading pitchers and taking an extra bag?
Yeah, I mean, that's a loaded question that we try to dominate every area of whatever we can do to, you know, to cheat. I mean, that's what stealing base is, to cheat, find a way. And so we have different variations. You know, we'll divide our guys up into what we call trucks and rabbits. Truck meaning Coach Barman might be able to identify with that with his great speed. Rabbits are the guys that go after it. So we'll break those guys down and build on their strengths. And, you know, obviously the guys that need an extra push, the guys that are trucks, we actually want them to learn more about momentum leads. They're going to have to cheat more to get stolen bases. And we've made a living on doing that when people fall asleep on guys who can't run. So we will definitely try to, you know, pick timing out. You know, we'll chart like crazy, do whatever we possibly can in the dugout. But at the end of the day, it's about confidence. It's about not having any fear of getting thrown out. There's technique that you can go over and over stealing bases, but it has to come down to anticipating, no fear, and understanding the flow of the game. So there's a lot of variables that go into that. I'd love to be able to send any information, whoever asks the question again, be more than happy to talk to you, email me. But it's a really good question, but it is a very in-depth question.
Absolutely. And yeah, it's a good point. A lot of our presenters have provided their email addresses and or social media handles. If there's anything that you want to request, please don't request the PowerPoints from me or the charts or whatever it is from me. I don't have them. They belong to the presenter. So please reach out to them directly, connect with them. I'm sure they'd be able to answer any of your questions even after we get done here. And speaking of that, it is 2:59 rolling on into 3:00 Eastern time, which means we are about done. I want to thank our presenters again, Link Jarrett, Rob Fournier, Liam Carroll. Thank you so much. Liam, give my regards to the Queen, please. Thank you so much for joining us today and for sharing with our attendees. We had hundreds of participants on here on Zoom. We had hundreds, if not thousands, on Facebook Live. We're going to have more people go through and watch these on YouTube. So we're reaching a really, really big audience from all around the world. Thank you guys so much. We'll be back. USA Baseball will be back Wednesday night for our Spanish language clinic. We got some great presenters coming in. Coach Frias will be there. Coach Fournier. We will be back with our Spanish language clinic. And starting right now, you can go to usabaseballshop.com, use the code CLINIC8 and get 20% off your entire purchase, including sale items. And be sure to, if you are those people who are getting your baseball fixed through the Korean Baseball League, check out, is it the KT Wiz, Rob? Is that who Mel's playing for?
Yes, absolutely.
Who was a third rounder out of there that we had the privilege to coach. He is Mel Rojas Jr. with the KT Wiz. Make sure you check him out. Gentlemen, thank you again. We appreciate you. And thank all of you attendees for tuning in and asking your questions. Growing as a coach today, we thank you. And we'll see you next time.